Under starter's orders.
What's a race we have in prospect here? He's charging up the hill, this wonder horse.
They're coming to the final fence, Mark.
He needs the jump of his life. He's over safely.
But he's coming up to the line. He's getting on the top of the dirt on the ground. Marco going away now from the line.
Back of the field, synchronized for AP McCoy, won the Gold Cup.
Winning the Gold Cup was the greatest day of my riding career.
And I was lucky enough to win it twice and one of the all-time greats.
And it really is the one that every National Hunt jockey wants to win.
The winner's enclosure this week has already witnessed some magical moments, from Rachel and Honeysuckle on Tuesday to the Flooring Porter team yesterday. I think those celebrations are still ongoing, but it's all been building to a crescendo, because at just after 3:30 this afternoon, there'll be the biggest cheer of them all.
Because this is Cheltenham Gold Cup Day. Not just a big day in racing, a big day in sport.
Wait. Come on!
And they're off.
Beautiful jump.
They're matching each other every step of the way. Who will prevail up the Cheltenham Hill? It's Native River who is fastest away.
Best mate, great jump.
Relentless, remorseless.
Here comes Long Run.
The final fence between Quarto Star and history. He's over. Heinigley, inexperienced, no object.
Denman and Imperial Commander, who are going to fight this out. Imperial Commander is charging up the hill.
Bosworth strikes the front.
Previous winners, past place getters and first-time Gold Cup aspirants lining up for a tilt at glory. Dual winner Al Boom Photo comes up first. He gave Willie Mullins his first Gold Cup. Could he give him a third today? Last year's runner-up Aplu Tai is out to avenge his defeat 12 months ago in the hands of Rachel Blackmore. Also for Team Mullins is the grey Astérion Forlonge, who has looked promising but unreliable at times. It's a first Gold Cup runner being sent out from the Scottish Borders stable of Harriet Graham and Gary Rutherford, and a first ride for Callum Bewley. Last year's Turner's winner Chantry House has a good record at Cheltenham, as do his trainer and jockey, but this is a test.
Francesca, number six, is the well-fancied Galvin for Ronnie Bartlett, Gordon Elliott and Davy Russell, who we hope will be fit. Manella Indo is the defending champion. He's not hit those heights this season yet, but he comes alive at Cheltenham. Then come three Brits. Protectorat is part owned by Sir Alex Ferguson. Money came for Royal Pagai when the rain arrived. The stable are having a golden week. Santini was second in 2020. This would be a fairy tale for trainer Polly Gundry. And the field is made up by King George winner Tornado Flyer under Danny Mullins, whom yesterday must have been a whirlwind. Behind closed doors and soulless last year. What a contrast 12 months later. We've got a Gold Cup with a sellout crowd and the most glorious setting. Exciting, isn't it? Just after 3:30, the Gold Cup. You've both won it. We saw Mick Fitzgerald and Sir Anthony McCoy, and 25 years on from your first one, who would you like to ride this year?
Do you know what, Ed, when I looked and watched last year's Cheltenham Gold Cup, you watch Manila Indo and you think, he'll win another Gold Cup. You know, I thought the same, I suppose, when I look back at an Imperial Call or even a Demon, or there's been, you know, but if I was to ride a horse, I think the most solid horse, I think he's been brilliantly trained. Look, I really want Chancery House to win for obvious reasons, but if he doesn't, Galvin would be the one I'd love to ride.
Chancery House owned by JP McManus, Galvin owned by Ronnie Bartlett. Do well to eat a crisp without him having played a part in it. Mick, what about for you?
I think Galvin is a really solid option. Great Cheltenham Festival record, winner of the National Hunt Chase. He's a stayer. You need a stayer to win the Gold Cup. He's ticking an awful lot of boxes. And I've been out on the track. It's drying all the time out there. It's going to suit the horses that want it a little bit drier than want it wetter.
I bet it's days like this and races like the Gold Cup that make you both wish you could put those boots back on and get out there. But listen, last year, Rachel Blackmore did a lot right, leading rider at the festival, but she was very honest on the opening show this morning, saying that the Gold Cup was the one that she got wrong, used up petrol at the wrong time in the race. How does she approach it differently this year?
Do you know what? You can get yourself in trouble by thinking too much about what happened last year. You've got to wipe the slate. You can't change what's happened. But what you can do is influence what's going to happen. She's got to go out there with a fresh plan and think, right, because plans change all the time in races. That's where good jockeys really come into their own. They're able to adapt their instructions to suit the way the race is being run. This could be a really tricky race to ride in this year. Lots of runners. Where's the pace going to come from? They're all the questions that need answering.
And it's lovely to have your company on what is an absolutely beautiful afternoon. This is going to be fun. Let's head out and about and hear from one of the heroes of yesterday.
Well, there were almighty scenes in the winner's enclosure yesterday as Florian Porter won his second stayer's hurdle. The man on board was Danny Mullins. That must have been some buzz on him.
Unbelievable, you know, great performance. And I suppose most of the credit would have to go to Gavin Cromwell, his preparation of the horse. You know, he's not the most straightforward individual. He's trained for one day all season and it's came off, everything went perfectly.
I saw some fascinating analysis from Ruby afterwards. I don't know whether you've seen it, just about the sort of technicalities of what you're doing with your hands. Firstly, how hard is that? And secondly, how much are you working on instinct?
At the back of the last, at that stage, you know, it's funny, normally he goes left. Last year he jumped it and went right. And yeah, it's just you need a fast reaction and do the right thing in the moment.
So you can't preempt that in any way?
No, it'd be a lot easier if I could, you know, that's just reaction and, you know, it's feel of what's going on underneath you, and you have to move fast before something goes wrong, because you're gone another half second there and you're away for another circuit and you're not gone to the finish.
And sorry if this is a stupid question, but does that just come with experience? You can't sort of prepare for that when you're younger, I imagine, or does moments like that happen fairly regularly?
Too regular, thank God. I suppose it's just being fit enough that you have a clear mind going down to the last, and you're able to think fast enough to react to make sure it happens.
And after there was no crowds here, nice to be on the shoulders of the owners in the winner's enclosure, I imagine.
Yeah, definitely. You know, last year was a very special day for me, and the lads thoroughly enjoyed it at home. But for them to come here this year, really soak it up, a record crowd at Cheltenham yesterday, and, you know, they were the ones really pumping it up.
Personally, I think you've got a great chance in the Gold Cup. Do you think Tornado Fly is underestimated?
I think so. You know, similar to the King George, you wouldn't say he's got a winning chance, but I think he's got a big each-way chance. And if the race unfolds the way we want and get into a nice rhythm halfway around, I think he'll be there in the mix at the finish.
Well done yesterday. Good luck later.
Thank you.
Yeah, Ollie's not the only one who fancies Tornado Flyer. Mick Fitzgerald thinks he's got a really good chance in the Gold Cup. He is the King George winner after all, but 3:30 is the time to remember for the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup. and we'll be building to it all day. And the warm-up acts aren't half bad either. Triumph Hurdle features some very exciting prospects. And it's a big field, Albert Bartlett, and it's got the enormous Hillcrest who goes for the Daily Stable. Don't forget, after the Gold Cup, it's the Festival Challenge Cup for the amateurs over course and distance of the Gold Cup. Just a few non-runners out of the 250, Falcon 8, and the real Wacker and Zamparelli comes out of the 410, that Challenge Cup.
This is the biggest jackpot we've ever had on the ITV7. £500,000 to be won on Boodle's Gold Cup Day. If ever there was a day to play the ITV7, folks, this is it. It was won earlier in the week, which is a great story. More on that later. I'm sure families up and down the land are having a go. Free to enter. You do have to be 18 or over. You can only enter once. And those are the seven races in today's game. You at home could win £500,000. Good luck, everybody. There aren't too many better vistas than here at Cheltenham. It's a place and a day that serves up moments that are etched in our memories forever. A day that makes legends. Welcome everyone to Boodle's Gold Cup Day here at Cheltenham. Cleve Hill has got to be the greatest backdrop in sport. There's the stage today. Three races and then the big one at 3:30. The Boodle's Cheltenham Gold Cup. Record crowds this week. And this is day four of a meeting where most of the year, Francesca, I keep being told the Brits are useless.
Well, yes. Let's check in with the current standings of the Prestbury Cup, because the final scoreline last year was 23 Ireland to Great Britain's 5. But this looks a lot better at this stage, doesn't it, with seven races still to go. The last time we had a draw was 2019. But after a year of soul-searching, I think the Brits can be fairly comforted by that current scoreline. Having said that, the Irish are still 1-10 to win it by the end of the day. Right, after we came off air yesterday, we had a couple more races here at Cheltenham. And it was a win for Love Envoy, who became the first British-trained winner of the Grade 2 Ryanair Mares Novices Hurdle since its inception in 2016. It was a second Channel Festival winner for trainer Harry Fry and the very first for jockey Johnny Burke.
Maybe these British trainers aren't so bad after all, because then came another. It was actually the ladies who took over in the last. Wonderful moment in the Kim Muir for jockey Lucy Turner. How talented is she? And another for Venetia Williams this week. Shambard winning at 40-1, a tenth on the week for the Brits.
It's been a busy 4 days for everyone working at the Cheltenham Festival, whether it's with the horses and hospitality or in broadcasting, both in front and behind of the cameras. But big smiles on the faces of our teams, because it is Gold Cup Day. Let's go out and say good afternoon to everyone, starting with Alice.
Yeah, thanks, Jessica. I'm going to be all across the course this afternoon, here in the pre-parade ring, out into the melee of the paddock, getting up close to the horses, and then joining in the celebrations of the winners up at the finish. I cannot wait.
I'm so lucky. I'm going to be down here at the start, close to the action. Galvin, he's been here before. We know Album Photo has Howell Protectorate Act. I'm going to be down here up close and personal. Didn't spend much time in the winners' enclosure, though. Rishi Prasad has, though.
Yes, there are a few more sacred places in the world of sport than the winner's enclosure at Cheltenham. And just after 3:30 today, one owner, one trainer, one jockey and one horse will return to this area of Cheltenham Racecourse after one of the greatest races in the world, the Cheltenham Gold Cup. Richard?
Yeah, that horse will have climbed the Cheltenham Hill. Fantastic scene here this morning, almost like a reveal as the mist drifted away to show Cheltenham off in all its glory. And the great thing this week, of course, is when that winner returns, the crowds will be here to celebrate. And the man who's been in amongst them all week is Chris Hughes.
Yeah, and the crowd are absolutely steaming in behind me. Of course, we expect nothing less on Gold Cup Day. So I'm going to get out and about, see who they fancy for the feature race this afternoon. And we want to hear from everybody at home on socials. Use the hashtag ITV Racing. Let us know who you think wins a big race and show us where you're watching from. Are you having a Gold Cup party? Let us know, because we'll be partying here at Cheltenham Racecourse.
So the team are all set, but two men that you can never get into a box. Brian and Matt, they're in the betting ring. What's it been like for the punters this week?
Well, you know what, Francesca, on Tuesday, better known as Honeysuckle Day, it was all about the punters. But what about the next 2 days, Brian?
I would say, Matt, at this stage, heading into Gold Cup, bookmakers are in front. 25-1 winner yesterday, 22-1 winner, and a 40-1 winner. And bookmakers got galloping the champ beaten as well. But punters are not worried about history. They're worried, they're looking forward. Gold Cup, big, big betting day, Matt.
It is a big betting day, so you could argue it's 2-1 for the bookies. So today, it'll be about a punter! Yeah! Of the biggest pitchers in the business. This is one of the biggest pitchers. White and Sunderland's came together a few years ago and they are huge. So who do they make favourite? A Plutarch, Brian, is 11-4. Galvin at 7-2. Who is else?
The money each way is for Al Boom Fodor, the dual Gold Cup winner, 12-1, 10-1, now into 15-2 at Sunderland.
The other market movers today, let's get to them. And at the top, you will see straight away the name Surprise Package, who of course was a big, big winner at Sandown the other day, 11 from 12. Broomfield Berg in the same race is 16 from 25. The big boy Hillcrest, 9-4 from 4-1. Then it's Al Boom Photo, 8 from 12. And I think the biggest gamble of the day will be Billaway in the Hunter Chase. We're ready, Brian. Do we think the punters are ready?
They are!
Good luck, Matt and Brian, in there. So the punters are ready, we're ready, but we need some tips to help us get underway. So let's head to Tipperary for our tips and find Kevin Blake. But just before we get into them, Kevin, more generally on the week, how have you seen it? And looking at that Prestbury Cup scoreline, thankfully, it's been a bit of a boost for the home team.
Yeah, I think so, Francesca. Look, last year was great on some levels, but I don't think it's in the best interest of the game for it to be so one-sided as it was last year. And look, this week has been great. The English trainers have been going well. The Welsh are on the board. The Scottish are on the board. It's been spread around a bit more. And I think that's a good thing, Francesca, because after last year, there was almost this fear factor all season. And some of the biggest trainers in Britain almost seemed reluctant to commit horses to Cheltenham. So I think what we've seen this week might just, you know, bring back an air of competitiveness about it, and we won't see any of that next season, and it may even be more competitive again this time next year.
Yeah, I agree 100%. It's definitely good for the game, isn't it? Right, so your selections, please, for this afternoon.
No problem, Francesca. For the nap, I'm going to the Triumph Hurdle at 1:30. I'm going for Phil Dore, which might surprise some people because Vauban, the favourite, very much put him in his place at Leopardstown last time. But that was a steadily run race, Francesca. The emphasis was on speed, and Vauban is a very fast horse, whereas Phil Dore is much more of a stayer in the making. You know, the Triumph Hurdle is a test of stamina, a test of galloping. There should be more pace in front of him today. And I just wouldn't be surprised if he makes a real good go at reversing that form with Vauban. For the next best, I'm going to the Albert Bartlett Novices Hurdle in the 250. Jinto is the one I'm with. A big clash with Hillcrest here. Should be a fabulous race. I've loved Jinto all season. He's unbeaten over hurdles. I didn't think making the running necessarily suited him. The Lawlers of Nace Novices Hurdle last time. I'm expecting an even better performance this time when something gives him a lead. And for the each-way selection, Francesca, a wild swing in the county hurdle at 10 past 2. Boa de Large, and the Irish haven't been faring all that well in the handicaps this meeting, but Boa de Large is a very big price. I was impressed with him winning a Fairy House last November. He came from last to first. The faster they go in front of him, the better it will suit him. I'm hoping he'll be finishing off very strongly, Francesca, and hopefully strongly enough to put himself bang in the finish.
Thanks, Kevin. I like that 22-1 about Boa de Large in the 210. Good luck to you.
And good luck at home as well, as we enjoy the action in Jumping's magical playground. We're wrapped in the arms of Cleve Hill, and we have the sport's most coveted prize this afternoon. Our build-up starts at just about 3 o'clock, and it's great to have you on board. I wonder what will happen up that famous Cheltenham Hill this afternoon. As we say, this is the biggest jackpot we've ever given away on the ITV7. Will it be won? Have a go, completely free to play. You at home could win £500,000 if you're 18 or over, and those are the races in the game today. It was won earlier in the week, and earlier on today, Ollie met the lucky winner.
Well, a massive jackpot in today's ITV7. Everyone should get involved, like this man did on Tuesday, Liam Worrell, who won £100,000. Congratulations.
Thank
That's
you.
Magic.
Thank you.
How much of a surprise was it?
A massive surprise. I'd forgot I'd done the actual pick seven, and I found out at about 11 p.m. Tuesday night that I was a winner. A bit of a run around the bedroom, celebrating, calling my dad.
I bet.
And it's still trying to sink in.
Where are you from and what do you do?
I live in Wigan and I'm a lighting manufacturer. So.
Did you have to go into work the next day?
I went to work Wednesday morning, told the boss that I'd won, and told him that I weren't working overtime this weekend. And he was happy for me, but he was like, everyone's been so overwhelming for me.
What are you going to do with the money?
A deposit on a house, debt free, and a nice holiday to New York.
Amazing.
And maybe a new car, see how much we've got left.
Am I right in thinking you've just had a baby girl as well?
Yeah, she's now a month old on Thursday just been, so this changes her life more than ours.
That's magic.
And I just can't wait to tell her the story when she's older.
Yeah, I bet she can't wait to hear it either.
No, yeah, she'll be telling all the friends in the school playground when she's older.
No overtime for you this weekend, quite right.
None for me this weekend, maybe next week. We'll see how we go.
Have you taken part today? £500,000 up for grabs?
I've taken part, yes. Anyone can win it, so why not me again?
Best of luck. You're an absolute superstar. We're so proud of you. Well done. And good luck with your ITV7 selections today.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Top man.
Thank you.
Isn't that brilliant? Well done to him. And good luck to everyone at home playing the ITV7 today with £500,000 to be won. And just look at the crowds as we head up to the right there and find Richard Hoyles.
Yeah, thanks, Ed. The JCB Triumph Hurdle gets us underway. The championship race for the four-year-olds run over 2 miles and a furlong. Just to remind you, they're going just drying out, good to soft, soft in places, fresh ground on the inside for the Gold Cup when we arrive there. So, the JCB Triumph Hurdle field headed by an outsider, 1 Ages of Man for Jonathan Moore, 2 the unbeaten Dr. Parnassus for Harry Skelton, and 3 Phil Dore for Davy Russell, 4 Ekare Allen for Mark Walsh, and 5 Il Était Temps for Danny
and Willie Mullins. Number six is Night Salute from Hattie Brennan. Seven, Coy Dodville, very much an outsider, Tom Scudamore. Eight, Lunar Power for Sean Flanagan. Nine, Pied Piper for Jack Kennedy, another with an unbeaten record. 10 is Porticello for Jamie Moore. 11, Teddy Blue for Josh Moore. And another from the Gary Moore camp, the old Tikram Colours, who won at the festival many moons ago. And number 12, Boban, Paul Townend for Willie Mullins. Paul and Willie, the leading protagonists in the week, teaming up here with another favourite. All 12 run in the JCB Triumph Hurdle, due off at 1:30.
What magnificent scenes we're bringing you here on ITV Racing. Look at that. Everyone just enjoying the big day. Vauban Richie deserves a change of luck, doesn't he? Gaelic Warrior touched off in the Boodles. Shakan coming down in the champion chase. 13-8, Vauban. The Pied Piper at 130, that is Burlington Bertie. Phil Dore at 11-2 looks great each way value for some. Iker Allen at 10. Il Était Temps at 12. Porticello for the Goshen team at 12-1. Night Salute for Milton Harris at 16-1. Dr. Panassas at 20, Teddy Blue at 40, and bigger prices elsewhere. Must just give a mention to Rita Shah's horse as well, bringing back memories of Oliver Brady. Pally Bay for drinking tea, Monaghan drinks brandy, and Castle Blaney beats them all for eating sugary candy. Brian, over to you.
Lovely touch, Matt, in memory of that wonderful character, Oliver Brady from County Monaghan. Seven Irish trained horses in the Triumph. We've won it 12 times, 11-10 in the Prestbury Cup, but the money is for Vauban, number 12, 13-8 into 6-4. You can see here £50,000 on Vauban along the rails here to win £131,250. That's 81. Thousands and change profit if Vauban wins. There's also another bet of 40,000 on Vauban. Great atmosphere down here on Gold Cup Day. Also 40,000 on the rails below. A 10 grand bet, Porticello at 14-1. Now into 10-1. And each way support for Davy Russell's mount. Field Door was 7-1, 13-2. Now into 5-1.
What a day to be alive, what a day to be jump racing. The crowd are 10 thick trying to see these horses for the first of our live races, the Grade 1 Triumph Hurdle. What a horse to fill the eye to get us underway. This is Porticello, one of two for Gary Moore. Long, rangy type. Obviously, he's only a baby because we're in the Triumph and he will fill into himself. But doesn't he cover a lot of ground? And so forward with his coat. Often at this time of year, they're still clipped. But this horse, right through with his summer coat, showing his well-being. And this is the other of the Gary Moore horses. Very different type, isn't he? Much more of a flat type in that he's a little bit shorter. You can see he's just getting a bit on his toes. He's got the hood on to keep him calm. Number 12, Vauban. This is the horse you want to see. This is the horse with the massive reputation from the Willie Mullins yard. They put the tongue tie on last time and that seemed to really help him finish his races. He's only small, isn't he? He's a little scrap. But my goodness, he's got an engine and comes here with an enormous reputation. Best of the British, potentially, is this little lad. Number 6, bidding to emulate the great Mysilve. The filly that won 5 on the bounce as a baby and came here and won this great race. Again, a little type. He doesn't stand out. You don't go, ooh, look at him. But Milton Harris's team have done an amazing job. And the story of Milton Harris, while he was out in the wilderness for 6 years, has got his team back together, has had the season of all seasons. They put the hood on again to keep him calm. He's a little scrap, but he's a little terrier.
What a welcome sight that is for Galvin fans in the Gold Cup. Davy Russell passed the doctor. He's fit to ride, and he'll ride Phil Dore in the JCB Triumph here as we go to Rishi.
Well, a big day ahead for everyone, but particularly for the man standing next to me, Rich Ritchie. He's got Vauban, the horse that I think a lot of people thought would be your best chance of the week. But you also need a bit of luck after some bad luck earlier in the week, Richie.
That happens, doesn't it? I thought going into the week he was our best chance. Gaelic Warrior was hard luck on Tuesday, but ran a great race. You know, it was a great plot. It just didn't quite happen. We were right to run. Shaq, he's just unlucky, isn't he? I know you like the horse as well. He's a lovely horse. He's fine after his fall. He was his unseat, really. He had a little cut, but he's okay. We could use a bit of change of luck. It was good to be in the winner's enclosure the other day with El Barra yesterday, but this fella is our best chance of the week, yeah.
Now, he is your best chance of the week. based on what we've seen in his two runs over hurdles so far. It was pretty good first time, much better the second time. Has the whole impression been that he's been even better since that win at the Dublin Racing Festival?
He's certainly improved. There seems to be a lot of confidence in the yard. That can mean a little, can mean a lot. I mean, the horse that was third behind us the last day is running today also in Woody's colours. And I hope he wins because his breeders are here. They've come all the way from France to watch today, so hopefully he wins.
Well, maybe there'll be a good omen for you.
We could use one.
Well, we wish you the best of luck. Great to have you here, and hopefully he runs a big race.
Thanks, Rishi. Cheers.
Yeah, the Irish do certainly seem to have the stranglehold on this race. Vauban for the Mullins Rich Ritchie team. And you've got Pied Piper for Gordon Elliott and Jack Kennedy. They both have looked super smart in their races leading up to this. Which one's better, Ruby?
I don't know, Francesca, but they have formed before. I mean, they met at Punchestown on New Year's Eve in a maiden hurdle. Vauban in the pink colours, Pied Piper just outside in the red. But Pied Piper jumped better on this occasion. First hurdle, jumped straight by Vauban. And at the second hurdle, after David Russell took back, he jumped by Vauban again. And that was it. Vauban never got past Pied Piper. Now, some will say it was Davy's riding at the last hurdle where he got in across in front of Paul Townend that won the race on this occasion. Maybe it was, but Pied Piper came here then on Trials Day and absolutely bolted in under Davy Russell. And Vauban went to the Dublin Racing Festival where he showed a good turn of foot to win, but it was what was most impressive was his jumping. He had improved a lot jumping-wise between Punchestown and Leopardstown, low and slick and quick at the last hurdle, where Field Door, who reopposes behind him, made a mistake. You also have Ilete Tomp and Iker Allen back there, but Vauban is very fast, so is Pied Piper. Field Door is the strongest there, as Kevin Blake has told you.
And there is Vauban in the Rich Ritchie silks, heading to post, spearheading the Irish challenge. What about the British challenge, Mick? We've got Dr. Parnassus for the Skeltons. There's Porticello. Many people will cheer on the Moors, and Matt said it after what happened to Goshen a few years ago. And there's Knight Salute. Now then, for the Four Candles partnership, so people who like the two Ronnies, I'm sure, will be cheering on Knight Salute. For the Adams family, who are Southampton fans, so I'm cheering them on. And for the trainer, Milton Harris, who you like very much. And am I right in saying he used to date Belinda Carlisle?
He certainly did. He's got a really nice picture in his office of him playing tennis, which was taken by Belinda Carlisle. Cary Grant was an old drinking buddy of his. He used to work on the cruise ships, and in the end he was bar manager. And he said he earned enough doing that job to set himself up in training.
He can train.
Oh, yeah, he's a real character. He's had 48 winners this season, Ed. He's having a fantastic season. It'd be a great story, and it would be a hell of a celebration. There will be tears if Knight Salute wins.
Who's going to win, AP?
I thought Piper actually was the looker in the paddock. Ed, I thought he really stood out. There's not much between him and Vauban. There really isn't, and as Kevin Blake has gone for Fildor, thinking there might be a stronger race, might suit him better. I think this horse actually is a good chance. He's improving all the time. He liked the ground. It would be great consolation. Porticello was to win, as Mick said, for the Mirrors, who had obviously that unfortunate with Goshen a few years ago. I think Porticello has a very good chance, and I think Iker Allen, you know, he won nicely last time. He was disappointed at the Dublin Racing Festival. I think you'll see a better showing from him today.
Then these pictures just look beautiful with the blue sky in the background. Coy Dodville for David Pipe and Tom Scudamore are leading down Vauban there. And be careful with the red colours, the Caldwell construction colours. It's the white cap on Pied Piper, the red one on Fildor. And I'll arrive with you shortly, I imagine, Luke.
Yeah, quite often in a lot of the championship races, they don't actually show them the first fence or hurdle because they just don't, you know, they all want to get a really good start. But because these are babies, I'm sure they've all come up. It's great to see Davy Russell, okay, this is Jack Kennedy just coming down. Good luck, Coy. He's a magnificent horse, isn't he, Jack? Absolute beauty he is. Pied Piper, here come the rest of the lads. Look at that, got a grackle noseband on this one. Nice. Not very big. That's ages of man just going past. And Jonathan Moore, there's a few more coming down. I'm looking forward to seeing Vauban. I can just see him in the distance. We'll see if we can grab a word in a second.
And Luke, just while they arrive with you, what's the difference between a grackle noseband and a normal noseband?
Basically, a grackle noseband. Well, most horses actually that run, Ed, wear a grackle noseband. It's just a cross noseband. So basically, it stops the horse crossing their jaw and just keeps their mouth shut, and it just helps their breathing. Hopefully, Paul Townend will come over here. This is Vauban just here. He's got a Graco nose band on. It's one of those things, whether it makes a massive difference is debatable, but it certainly doesn't do them any harm. That is for sure. Just see it going past us there. Teddy Blue jig-jogging away. See, this lad's got a Graco nose band on. See, look at that cross nose band there. Just helps the jockey, helps him to breathe. And another one, he is the favourite. Good luck, Paul. Look at that horse. Look at that intelligent horse. Absolute cracker, isn't he?
He is lovely, isn't he, Vauban? And interesting to hear that Melbourne Cup aspirations potentially for him later on in the season. But do you think the market's got it right here, Mick? Because we've got all the Irish horses to the fore. But Knight Salute, he's got really good form. Porticello as well. Are they too big?
Yeah, and Porticello and Knight Salute are quite closely matched on running in that summit hurdle up at Doncaster. Porticello made a mistake late on. Plenty of people feel he can turn the tables if he jumps better. And looking at the horses walk around, Porticello stands out. He's a really
lovely,
nice, big, strong horse, actually. He's impressive to the eye.
What's it like to ride in a race like this on these youngsters?
You know, it's not bad now because it's a smaller field. It makes things a little bit easier and there's plenty of space. You've got plenty of time with only two hurdles in the last seven furlongs. So stamina is the key here.
I didn't mind the look of Il Était Temps, who's yet to win over hurdles, but I think he's quite eye-catching when he came third to Vauban last time out.
Yeah, ran really well, Francesca. Look, he's running. She's running this race, I'd imagine, because they'll be hoping if she doesn't win, there'll be a novice for next year, so it will. So that's the reason why, you know, it's a great place to lose your novice tag if you win the Triumph, isn't it? Otherwise, I wouldn't be surprised if they're thinking it may be a supreme novice horse for next year.
Luke just came in my ear and said Jamie Moore had a word with him and said, I can't believe I'm going to get a freebie in a Triumph third. So keep a very close eye on the yellow colours near the front, the Harris colours, Jamie Moore riding for his dad. There he is. Will he get a freebie off the front? Pied Piper, remember, in this race, bred by the Queen. As the flag goes up, I reckon we might get quite a roar here, Richard, because the crowd are absolutely buzzing.
And there you go, Ed, quite on cue. Short run to the first, Porticello is indeed handed an uncontested lead on the run towards the first of eight. Phil Dore, the grey, is in close attendance. They all pop over the first. Il Était Temps flattened it, taking a really keen hold. It's the grey horse in fourth place on the far side, head from side to side for Danny Mullins, just trying to settle the horse and fighting them at the moment. So Porticello and Phil Dore make their way up towards the second. Two lengths clear of Icare Allen, who races in third. Vauban in the pale jacket is in fourth, just ahead of the keen Il Était Temps, who races on the inside of the other red and white colours with the white cap. That is Pied Piper, who races in sixth. On the outside of Ages of Man, Black Jacket, White Face, Luna Power also white faced in the bright pink colours, then Dr. Parnassus and Knight Salute, the unbeaten pair, the last two early on, Coy Dodville and Teddy Blue, as the run towards the second is just about complete. Phil Dore and Porticello are over. Not the best of leaps by Vauban, who landed rather on all fours as the crowd enthusiastically send them away, packed in front of the stands this afternoon. And out in the lead, Porticello disputing it there with Phil Dore. That spectacular backdrop, hardly a vantage point to be had, with three lengths back in third to Icare Allen. Vauban races in fourth place early on. Il Était Temps on the inside of Pied Piper, and they fill out the first half of the field. Racing in seventh place is Luna Power with Dr. Parnassus and Knight Salute. Coy Dodville, Teddy Blue are currently racing towards the back of the pack. And Ages of Man is last of all. Porticello and Phil Dore jump that well. Slight mistake in third by Icare Allen, who just jumped slightly to the left. So this is where the hurdles come pretty fast for these young horses. Porticello and the Greyfield Door, they step over it from Vauban on the outside of Icare Allen. Il Était Temps still racing fiercely on the inside of Pied Piper. Then behind these is Luna Power and Dr. Parnassus. As the leaders step over the next flight, Knight Salute made a mistake on the inside there, just wrapped the way through it. And at the back of the field, Ages of Man is just struggling to keep up slightly as they climb towards the third last. So the Greyfield Door has disputed the running with Porticello throughout. They remain three lengths clear from Icare Allen and Vauban in third and fourth places. Pied Piper and Il Était Temps in the next two, with Dr. Parnassus taking closer order on the outside of Luna Power and Knight Salute as they reach the third last at the top of the hill. Over in the lead was Porticello, from Phil Dore in third place Icare Allen, Vauban in fourth, and then Pied Piper's white cap on the outside of Il Était Temps. Second half of the field are a little closer. Dr. Parnassus on the outside of Knight Salute, between the pair Luna Power, Coy Dodville, Teddy Blue and Ages of Man. So the field strung out by only about 12 lengths as the leaders run downhill then towards the second last. Still a fair run before they reach it, and out in the lead, Porticello in the yellow colours on the inside of the grey field door. Third place for Ikare Alen, in fourth is Vauban. Plenty still travelling well. Pied Piper behind runners, Ilette Aiton still taking a fierce hold. Then Knight Salute and Dr. Parnassus as they race towards the second last in the Triumph. Porticello over in the lead with Phil Dorr. Vauban on the outside between horses. Pied Piper improves. And then towards the inside is Ikare Alen. They are the front five from Dr. Parnassus as they turn for home. Phil Dorr and Porticello. Vauban's pink jacket towards the outside. Pied Piper in the white cap, also white cap Ikare Alen. Ilette Aiton as Vauban now makes his move for Paul Townend against the rails, shadowed through by Pied Piper, and Phil Dorr still there. Ikare Alen and Ilette Aiton behind these. Porticello fades away. Vauban still has the narrow lead, pursued now by Pied Piper and Phil Dorr as they hit towards the last. Vauban accelerates into it, steps at it, doesn't land with much momentum, and now it's an all-out struggle to repel Phil Dorr and Pied Piper, but Vauban regains the momentum and powers away to win the JCB Triumph. Vauban for Paul Townend and Willie Mullins. Phil Dorr just repels Pied Piper second and third. Ikare Alen, Ilette Aiton, Porticello, Dr. Parnassus, Luna Power, Knight Salute, Teddy Blue behind those, Coy Dodville and Ages of Band. Despite bungling the last, Vauban picked up and moved away in the style of a very smart youngster. Phil Dorr stuck to the task well, Pied Piper. They held every chance, second and third, in a clean sweep for the Irish, and they moved clear of the others, headed by Ikare Alen, fifth place Ilette Aiton. Still, it's an Irish domination. Porticello is the first home of the UK runners, but a well-beaten sixth. Vauban returns to the winner's enclosure, another winner for Paul Townend and Willie Mullins in the colours of the Riches.
Yes, it was the Irish powerhouses going head-to-head up the hill. Mullins won it for that man again. So good yesterday, on the board already today, Paul Townend.
Paul, he showed his class after bungling the last a little bit. My goodness, the engine off the back of it.
It's there all right, isn't it? We ought to say he was kind of a work in progress, and he's improved every day, and he can improve again, I think. Some mudding old gallop, and, you know, he's learning about National Hunt racing all the time, and hadn't planned on being in front down to the last, if the truth be told. It's just the way it worked out, and he had a little look around, and I knew there was loads there if I got to the back of it.
And very special to ride a winner in these colours.
Very important, yeah. Look, Rich and Susanna are big supporters of our team, everyone in there. They had no luck so far this week, but they have a good one on their hands here.
Well done.
Thanks.
And Rich Ritchie knew. He told us beforehand this was their best of the week. He hadn't had much luck until now, but Rich Ritchie now has, with Susanna, his wife, their 19th Cheltenham Festival victory, as Vauban gets met by Adam Connolly, who looks after him. And Ruby's pretty smart.
Oh, he is, Ed. You were asking the other day, would Sir Gerhard go champion hurdle or not? But I think this fella is more a champion hurdle horse, to tell you the truth. I know he's only a 4-year-old, but he's a 98 rated flat horse. He's a very fast horse. I was hoping he'd get the trip on the Triumph Hurdle, which is 2-1 on the new course, but they went in muddling gallop. The fractions were slow early. Paul got up into a, as he said himself, he didn't want to be in front this soon. He knew he was riding the fastest horse, but he was in a commanding position for the sprint. You can watch his ears going to the last. He has a good look, backs off it and lands in a heap, but you knew by Paul's body language that he always felt that he had plenty of gears. And as soon as he goes from him, Phil Dorr and Pied Piper join him. As soon as Paul flicked him twice with his right hand, the change of gear was so impressive, and he's hit the line strong. It's brave to think a 4-year-old can turn into a, or a 5-year-old, as he, 4-year-old as he is now, into a champion hurdle horse, but this could be one.
Ruby, his jumping I didn't think was slick enough for a champion hurdle horse. Is that something you think they can work on?
Oh, definitely, Mick, and he'll have to work on it. But look, he came off the flat more so than out of a jumping yard in France, so he's had the Willie Mullins mode of schooling, and I'm sure he'll get a lot more of it and get a lot better at it. He didn't come as a main horse.
But might he go back to the flat in between, Ruby, for a tilt in the Melbourne Cup?
No. Maybe he will in time, but I doubt it. I'd say if you ask Willie Mullins now, he'll have his eyes set on the champion hurdle. And Francesca, it's only when he fails as a jumper William Mullins will consider the Melbourne Cup.
Ouch!
That is a line and a half, that, Ruby. I love it. He's going to be courted, I bet you, by York for the Ebor, by the Australians for the Melbourne Cup, which, well, he's never won. 6-4 favourite.
Max Dynamite was second, but that was after he had proven he couldn't be a jumper.
Ruby, do you think that Paul rode him, like, the way, would you have spoke to Paul about riding that? He seemed to keep him out a little bit, give him a little bit of light. And the first thing he wanted to do was get over onto that rail on this side. You know as well as anyone, it's always a good advantage. You can see here on this angle, to get over onto that rail and something to run to. No, he was the best horse. You know, I thought he was very good for Paul at the last. You know, sometimes you give a horse a squeeze like that and they do nothing. But he's got a lot of talent, hasn't he?
Yeah, but that's what Paul was saying. It wasn't the plan to be in front so soon. I only spoke to him a half an hour ago, AP, and he's, what did you think? And I said, we ran the fastest horse and I've never seen someone come too late in the Triumph Hurdle. And he texts me back, ideal. So his plan wasn't to do what he did, but you have to adapt to the situation that you're in and ride the race that you, as it unfolds in front of you. You can go out with plans, but every good jockey has to be able to change. And when they went slow, Paul had to change tactics.
Yeah, it just looked like he was trying to keep it as simple as possible and have no excuses for him. Russell, it looked like watching him.
And it was a speed test, Mick, and the second and third, you can see there, particularly the horse on the left, yeah. Field Door, just looks to me as though that didn't particularly suit him. And he could be some chaser, couldn't he?
Yeah, he's got a bit of size and a bit of scope, but I thought he's run a really good race. I think the Elliott team will be delighted with their two horses. Pipe Piper has run a really good race too. But
well, coming second and third to Willie Mullins.
They'll be pleased with how they've run, but they'll be disappointed to get beat. I think they've bumped into a smart horse here, like he was just by far and away the best.
And Paul Townend on the board again after his up-and-down day yesterday. And it's a big day for him, of course, reunited with Album Photo at 3:30. He's won two Gold Cups. Ruby?
Yeah, look, it is a big day for him. Look, he was great value early in the year at 20-1. He's probably a realistic price now, but Paul has great belief in him. And after riding the winner of the first, he bounced back yesterday, but I wouldn't be surprised if he changes tactics later on Album Photo and tried something a bit different on him, but... His back is up, he's on the crest of a wave, and I know the Gold Cup would mean a lot, a third Gold Cup would mean a lot to him.
When you say try something a bit different, Ruby, the first two Gold Cups that he won, do you think he was inclined to be handier coming down the hill? Do you think he could be more aggressive on him this time?
I think he will. He's a 10-year-old, there's no great pace in the race. I'd be shocked if he's not more aggressive on him.
Could he even make the running?
He could. I wouldn't be surprised if he did. He'd be bang up there anyway, I would think.
Lots more on that as we build up to the Boodles Gold Cup at 3:30. But look at that on our Falcon camera. What pictures we've had from this camera in the week as we swoop in over the winner. Boban has won the JCB Triumph Hurdle. Big high five from Joe Chambers, the racing manager for the Ritchie family. Susanna's, Ritchie's colours, winning again at Cheltenham, courtesy of Vauban. In the orange there, £2.50, that is the tote return. 6-4 favourite, Phil Dorr was second at 11-2. Perfect start for the Irish, 12-10 now. Perfect start for favourite backers as well. It turned into a speed test, and despite a mistake at the last, Vauban, an impressive winner of the Triumph. This glorious day, Gold Cup day at Cheltenham, there's our first winner, Vauban, for the Ritchies in the JCB Triumph Hurdle. Amazing analysis from Johnny Murto, just sent a WhatsApp to say, good trainer that, Willie Mullins.
Well, before the race, he said, best chance of the week, and Vauban has delivered. Were you ever worried at all during the race, Rich?
Wouldn't have a clue, didn't see it. I turned around to watch him jump the last, and he flattened it, but... Gee, when Paul asked him to go, he had so much pace left, didn't he? When Joe Chambers was talking me through the race, he was saying we were jumping well. We when they came alongside us, he got a little bit keen and started jumping to his right. But he's a proper little taxi, isn't he?
He is.
Now,
the world seems to be his oyster. And I know it's always awkward to ask an owner or a trainer in the immediate aftermath of victory what the plans might be, but we've been told he's getting quotes for the Melbourne Cup, the Champion Hurdle next year, all sorts of options. What's your instinct telling you about the future for him?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, we bought him as a dual campaigner, so I wouldn't mind running him on the flat. David Casey gave me a big hug after the race and said, Ebor, then on to Melbourne. but, you know, certainly with that performance, well, he jumped much better today. So, you know, Champion Hurdle has to be in our plans. We'll have a chat, but I wouldn't mind keeping him on the go now for a little bit. He's lightly raced. You know, he's a listed winner on the flat in France, and he'd be a lot of fun to have on the flat, wouldn't he?
Now you've got the monkey off the back for the week. The rest of the day could be quite interesting. I know you've got 5 o'clock later on, but I need to ask you about Royal Pagai. Obviously, the rain that fell here early in the week was hugely in your favour. What are you thinking about the chances now? Venetia's horses can form.
Venetia's horses are running brilliantly. And when the heavens opened on Wednesday, I was so excited. I thought, oh, here's our chance. It's probably gotten a bit too quick for him. But the way he ran at Newbury the last day is the best he's ever jumped on quick ground. And while it won't be that quick today, you know, he's got a chance to run to a place. I'd love to see him run well, particularly for Venetia. And he's a fantastic horse to own. He's a lovely chap.
Momentum now on your side, Rich. Well done.
I hope so. Thanks, Richie. Cheers.
So owner Rich Ritchie can hardly bear to watch when his horses run. But Ruby, I imagine you would have enjoyed that and not missed a second of it. What did you pick up?
I did. Look, and we were talking, or myself and Nick were having a discussion about Vauban's jumping, but actually it was a lot better than I thought. And we'll pick him up from the start and just bounce through them all as quick as we can. Good position to the first. And he was a bit slow at the first hurdle, maybe. The second hurdle wasn't spectacular either. He gets in quite close when he could have stood back, but it got much better in the back straight. Good at the third hurdle. He was slick, always in Paul's hands, and the same at the fourth. But when he needed him at the fifth from the overhead, he really stands back and has a cut, flies that, and again at the sixth, he's a little bit tight at that, but quick enough at it. He's not losing ground to the horses either side of him. Second last, he's not really in shot. Looks like he goes a bit to his right. But at the last hurdle in, and we'll slow it down for you, it'll just show you how much petrol he had in the tank. As he hits this halfway up, still manages to get his feet out really quickly, and then quicken up. He had a lot left in the tank, that horse, because you have to have energy to keep yourself standing in that situation.
He's got huge amounts of ability, hasn't he? Exciting to see that young-looking star, Vauban, winning the Triumph Hurdle. But now, back to popular demand, it's Chris Hughes out and about for us.
Now, a hugely popular area of Festival Week is the shopping village. Lots of people come down here, spend some money, and I'm in a shop where they do that, I imagine, themselves. This is Stevenson Brothers, a family-run business. I'm with Mark and Kyle here. Tell me a little bit more about this rocking horse company.
We had an uncle that used to make rocking horses, so my twin brother and I, Tony, decided 40 years ago that we'd learn to make them. And we thought we'd become the best rocking horse makers in the world. And having been here now for 25, 30 years, we are. You know, we make horses for all sorts of people all over the world, and we actually copy their own horses a lot of the time. So we've had a fantastic week, and here's a fantastic horse that you could have.
Yeah, I can see in the background there, Carl, that's the legend Tiger Roll.
Really is, you know, ran a fantastic race, but retiring this week, but we love him, you know, absolute legend.
And tell me a little bit more about the sentimental value. You can see there in the tail.
Yes, we've got his own tail hair here. You know, a lot of customers like to do that. Really just makes the horse personal and unique.
And I believe that's for David Russell himself?
Is indeed.
There we are. Job done. Boys, fantastic. Hope lots of people come down and check this out. Some amazing craftsmanship.
Thank you very much.
Keep doing what you're doing. Yeah. I hope you have a good week.
We've had a wonderful day.
Good man. All the best, boys. Thank you.
Unfortunately, rocking horse is about the only kind of horse I can ride at the moment, but never mind. Now, all week, Ollie's been treating us to his behind-the-scenes masterclasses, and today we find out the role of the race day stewards.
Well, in our latest masterclass here at Cheltenham, we're going to focus on something that we see a lot through the year, and that is stewarding. Stewards' inquiry is something that's very common in British racing, but what exactly is the process that is involved with regards to stewarding and stewards' inquiries? Well, here to tell us more, I'm glad to say that Sean Parker joins us, who is the head of the stewards. Sean, thank you very much for your time. Just explain, if you can, we've got runners ahead of the Boodles in the paddock behind us. What is the process for you and your team between now and sort of when the race is done as such?
So, Ollie, before the horses leave the paddock, we then split up the team. We have some of the team members up in the side-on box, viewing the horses live with binoculars. The balance of the field, then, once the horses have left the parade, we will go through to the stewards' room. and we'll watch those horses cantering down to the start. That's just purely from a welfare point of view to make sure they've all got down there in an orderly fashion. If anything concerns us in terms of the way the horses have gone down or they've misbehaved or possibly may have injured themselves on the way to the start, we can then assist the veterinary officers and the starters and ask for that horse to be checked at the start.
And then during the race, you're looking at pretty much every angle of the race to see if there's interference, if there's anything that you need to flag up in your review after the race.
Yeah. So on any normal day, we'd have 5 different angles we'd be viewing at a normal race meeting. Up to the festival day, so today we're lucky, we might have about 12 different angles we'll be watching on any given day. That just allows us to watch the race from start to finish. And the key point there, obviously, is just to make sure that the rules are basically followed, that the result is fair for all participants, that it's safe for all participants. And we will then view those races literally from start to finish.
My final question is, we hope that there is never interference in a race, but often there is. So what happens if there is interference?
So the process, once the horses have crossed the line, there is immediately a discussion between the two stewarding sessions on the race day, the side-on box and the stewards' room. And the first point we've got to do there is just to make sure that we are satisfied that the result is correct in terms of the horses crossing the post, and then to decide if there's any incident on the run to the line that we feel may have a bearing on the result of the race. That will then result in us following a discussion, calling a steward's inquiry, or putting out a review notice that there's an incident we want to try and have another look at just to make sure that we are happy with the result. Once we've satisfied that the result's right and that there is no reason for any steward's inquiry, we'll then go through the race again from all the angles from start to finish, checking the reports, any information we feel is relevant for the public to know in terms of anything that may have affected a horse's run in a race, that we can notify the public what may or may not have happened to their horses in a race, and then any transgressions of the rules. So if there have been any, we would then obviously going through the rules book, viewing the patrol videos, hold an inquiry, get the evidence we need to on the day, and then decide if any other action should be taken against any of the riders riding in that particular race.
The next race here at Cheltenham is a big field handicap, so we hope for no interference, but we'll have our cameras in there and watch you and your team do your thing. Good luck.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, thankfully, just the one inquiry this week on of our televised races, which we got to see yesterday, but we will never tire of seeing this, will we? Record crowds all week at the home of National Hunt Racing. It's Gold Cup Day in all its glory.
Now ahead of the county hurdle, I've just jumped off the podium, and often I say on ITV, you at home have got the best seat in the house. Well, I've got the best position in the house right now. I've actually borrowed a box off Willie Carson. I can see everywhere. Just look behind me here at Cleve Hill and the racetrack. And then if we come to the left here, it's clearly thirsty work watching the racing. The Guinness Village is absolutely packed. And everyone buzzing about, having a lovely time in this glorious sunshine. The packed stands are just stunning, aren't they, on a day like today. Likewise, the parade ring. And if we come across here, I've got a restaurant to my left, and this is the Princess Royal stand. And when it was built, so clever. Just look at the vantage point these people get on the various balconies. And it created this incredible amphitheatre you're looking at now. Look up the top there with people looking down on the horses. And when Tiger Roll did his thing this week and Rachel on Tuesday with Honeysuckle, it was absolutely incredible. If you haven't been to Cheltenham before, put it on your bucket list, particularly this magical 4 days of the festival. And this is Gold Cup Day, and we've still got 4 really good races to come.
Next up is one of the big handicaps of the week, the McCoy Contractors County Handicap Hurdle, Grade 3, 2 miles and a furlong, and a big field. They're headed by number one, Call Me Lyrene. Rob James claims 7 for Gordon Elliott. 2 is My Mate Mozzie. Kieran Buckley claiming 5 for Gavin Cromwell. 3, Tritonic for Adrian Heskin and Alan King, the McNeil family, and Ian Dale running in Ian's colours on this occasion. 4 is Bally Adam for the Chipley Park Stud, 2nd in the Supreme. 12 months ago, Aidan Coleman riding for Henry de Bromhead. 5 is Felix Desji, Jack Kennedy for Gordon Elliott, Giggins Town's first colours, maroon with the white star on the cap. Number 6 is Dysart Diamond. Her partner is Jack Foley, claiming 3 for Willie Mullins. Number 7 is Favoir. Bridget Andrews has a really good record on this horse, teaming up with Dan Skelton for owner Suzanne Lawrence. Number 8 is First Street. Nicola Boyneville for Nicky Henderson, the Lady and Alice Bamford. Number 9 is Cask Mate. Dennis O'Regan for Noel Mead and the High Spirits Racing Club, black and red. 10, I Like to Move It for Sam and Nigel Twiston Davis for Anne-Marie and Jamie Shepherd. And number 11 is Jesse Evans. Noel Mead again represented, this time with Sean Flanagan, aboard for owner Jack Singleton. 12 is Far Out for Brian Hayes, another from the Willie Mullins yard, thoroughbreds, green and yellow. 13 is West Cork, one of the leading fancies for Harry and Dan Skelton, Mike and Eileen Newbold, West Cork, number 13. Number 14 is Irascible, Ryan Cooper for Henry de Bromhead. White cap here on a grey horse. 15 is State Man, Paul Town and Willie Mullins. Willie now 4 clear, leading trainer for the week. One more will surely see it. 16, Colonel Mustard. Very similar colours here to 18. Colonel Mustard, Connor Orr for Lorna Fowler. 17, splitting that pair is Surprise Package, the horse we saw win the Imperial Cup at the weekend. Kevin Sexton for Peter Fahey. This is the other similar colours. 18, Top Bandit, also red, white, diamond. White nose for Top Bandit, but they are similar, those two. 19, Cormier, looking for the more battle bonus, having won that race at Kelso in front of our cameras a couple of weeks ago. £100,000 if he can win here as well. 20, Guadalage, lively outsider, Rachel Blackmore for Henry de Bromhead. 21, looks an absolute picture in the paddock, including a shamrock on the rear end. Jordan Game for claiming 3 for Gordon Elliott. 4th in this race 12 months ago. Definitely one to be interested in. 22, Tax for Max, Sean O'Keefe. Another for Willie Mullins. 23, Booer Boy. Booer Boy for Dennis Hogan, jockey and trainer. 24 is Broomfield Berg, John O'Neill Jr., McManus Hoops for trainer Nicky Henderson. And still they come. 25, Stepney Causeway, Jack Andrews claiming 5, Dan Skelton. 26, Tempo Chapter 2 for Danny and Willie Mullins. Every single one of them run. Maximum field of 26 for the McCoy Contractors County Handicap Hurdle, one of the big betting races of the week, Matt.
It really is, Richard, it really is. And Willie Mullins really doing the same thing as he tried to do with Gaelic Warrior early in the week in the Boodles. Winner handicap with a very lightly racehorse. Only thing Stateman hasn't been entered in recently is the boat race. 11-4 Stateman, could be anything. Colonel Mustard, he'll have the Pro Kush to help him rather than the Candlestick, 6.5-1. I Like to Move It, Move It is 15-2. West Cork is 15-2. I Like to Move It is 8-1. Surprise Package is one of the market movers of the day at 9. Big winner at Sandown at the weekend. Top Bandit at 11. Broomfield Berg, well back from a Manus. You watch the market with that owner, 14-1. First Street at 16 could run well. My Mate Mozzie at 20 and Tax for Max at 22. 25-1 bar. But, Brian, it's all about the Stateman.
It certainly is, Matt. The sun is shining and the Willie Mullins double this morning was Vauban and Stateman in around 10-1. You had your few quid on the double.
Absolutely. I think it's a question of how far for Stateman.
You have the colours as well, the Donnelly colours, of course, of Shishkin, Album, Photo and Stateman. Could be a grade one horse lurking in a handicap. You can see local bookmaker here, the Simmons family from local Siren Sister. Stateman 3-1. Colonel Mustard 11-2. West Cork 15-2. Surprise Package for the five family. Of course, won the Imperial Cup at Sandown on Saturday at 9-1 to complete the big double. Broomfield Berg of JP McManus 14-1. First Strand 16-1. What about Jesse Evans, a pony 25-1? But there's no talk about the 80-1 shot. Caskmate running for the High Spirits Racing Club 80-1. Now that's a big price each way.
It's absolute mayhem in the paddock here ahead of this handicap. And let's start with number 16, Colonel Mustard. A name you might not know in terms of the trainer, Lorna Fowler. She's a small trainer. She's got a great history in terms of horses, and she's done a brilliant job with this horse. He's got incredible form. You're looking at it. It's got Jean Bon, it's got Sir Gerhard, and here he is in a handicap. Beautifully presented here today. Good luck to the small Lorna Fowler team heading for the biggest day of her career. Number 19, here's Cormier, Brian Ellison. He's an absolute wizard. He's up for the 100 grand bonus after that Kelso win you might have seen with us on ITV. Jack Cross leading up. He will love the ground. And unbelievably, Brian looking for his first festival winner. Here's number 10. Have you got him, Damo? Here he is. It's I Like to Move It. And when he won here earlier in the year, they play the music when the winners come in. I'm not going to sing it, AP. You might. But you might know the tune that this horse came into. And he's called I Like to Move It because Nigel Twiston Davis's little boy, Teddy, he named him because it's his favourite song from his favourite movie. And Nigel put this up as his best chance of the week.
Well, obviously, this is a hugely competitive race, but a particular edge added to it for connections of Cormier, because he, if he wins today, is in line for a 100 grand bonus, having won the Moor Battle at Kelso. Dan Gilbert, part owner, what do you think his chances are of landing that pot today?
Slim, I would think.
Really?
Well, it's just it's much more competitive race than Kelso. And yeah, if he comes in the first four, he's run as well as he ran at Kelso, so... The 100, it's a great bonus from Kelso, much appreciated, but I don't think we're going to be taking it.
Give people who like Cormier a little bit of hope, because, of course, okay. He disappointed here in the Great Wood, but that was a blip. Since then...
He made such a bad mistake throughout in the Great Wood, ignore that. And then if you went over course and distance like he did, it wasn't a strong run race, he was going away at the finish. He's £9 higher, it'd probably stop him winning, but he might be fourth or fifth or third. Or... There's some really unexposed ones in there, and it depends how they run, really. But he's a solid one, isn't he? If he's not in the first seven or eight, I'd be disappointed, but I'd be surprised if he won.
There's a little more hype in that last answer, so fingers crossed for that. Best of luck.
All right, thanks. Cheers.
Cheers, thank you.
Yeah, good luck to the team with Cormier. Dan Gilbert there, he lives just over the road from Cheltenham, so it'd be great for him to have a local winner, although realistic about their chances. But... Where do we start here?
Stateman.
Stateman. Yeah.
And Ruby, we often talk about these races, the hustle and bustle of a handicap hurdle at Cheltenham. How worried are you about his inexperience?
Look, it has to be a concern, but different tracks and different races at Cheltenham, I think inexperience becomes a bigger thing. And I think the county hurdle is probably the easiest race for inexperienced horses to win. There's less jumping on the new track in Cheltenham. You've more room and more space than you have on the old course. So I think it stacks up for novices to win the county hurdle easier than it does the Coral Cup or even the Portemps. That's my feeling anyway.
Ruby, how's he going to ride him? Because watching him run, he looks like he can grab the bit, and looking at him going to post, he can be a little bit keen as well.
Same as any race, Fitzy. I suppose if they go hard, he'll sit in. If they go steady, he'll be closer to the pace. But look, he'll ride him like he's the best horse. We think he's well treated. If he hasn't got enough experience, he hasn't got enough experience. But you still have to ride him like you believe in him. So I think he'll be two-thirds of the way back and be arriving with his challenge going to the last, I'd be hoping.
It is a very light CV, though, isn't it? He's only had the three starts. Could he be a bit like Sam Felician in the Coral Cup, where the big hustle and bustle of a handicap like this is too much at the start?
Very possibly. He looks very raw, this horse. When you watch him in these races, like he doesn't race like an experienced horse, and that's definitely a worry if you're backing him. But if he's got so much in hand, he might be able to overcome it. But you have to take it into account.
And you know the owners of Colonel Mustard in the red and white, the Frosts, Pete Davis, the Fowlers, what have they told you?
Oh, look, they're really sweet on this horse's chances. And he, if you go through some of this horse's form, it stacks up. Sir Gerhard finished behind that, finished behind John Bon. So, got to have a squeak.
And one thing that you might not know about the trainer, Lorna Fowler, is that she gave Henry Cecil his very, very only Cheltenham winner when she rode in a charity race here for him. That's the trainer, Lorna Fowler of Colonel Mustard. I actually caught up with her before the race. She said, look, he lacks a bit of experience, but... he's got very good form, and they avoided the novice race.
You're always picking up on my grammar. Very only. I've not heard
that. I know,
that
was a bit rough. Day four, Ed.
Now, Luke, are they coming to see you?
Do you know what? The incredible thing is, Ed, that
people are so conscious of getting good starts now. So normally they'll come down, obviously, you see over there by the ambulance, they come down that walkway, that canterway down here. They'll come over, show them the practice hurdle here, all mill around here, get the girths checked, and then go out into the course. But look, they've already, because people are so worried about not getting a good start, they've already gone straight out onto the track. There are a few stragglers here that are just coming down. You can see just there's Dice Up Dynamite there. Some of the bigger prize horses a little bit further down. That's Tax for Max just going through. Sean O'Keefe. But yeah, absolutely incredible. And I know people at home sit there and think, what on earth? You've got, you know, 2 miles to sort yourself out. But the start is just so important.
If I was riding, I think I'd be scared at this moment in amongst them. Look at that. Imagine when they're going at 35 miles an hour. Let's get some betting.
This will be a bagged result for off-course bookmakers should Stateman win. Lots of people on the double this morning. Vauban and Stateman at 10-1 and 11-1. 11-4 now, Stateman, a 10 grand bet at 3-1. West Cork also supported in the market, a 5 grand bet at 8-1, now into 13-2. Colonel Mustard for Lorna Fowler, 13-2. I like to move at number 10. I saw two individual 5 grand bets in readies at 9-1 to win 45,000 each, now into 8-1, 9-1 surprise package, and it's 10-1 bar. Stateman, very popular, 11-4. He could be a graded horse in a handicap. Expect him to be coming late. He's favourite. Can he land the big first race double on Gold Cup Day? Punters think so.
And the jockey can there is on John Joe O'Neill Jr., who's riding Broomfield Berg in the green and gold of JP McManus. Would he be your pick here?
He has a chance. It'll be great for the jockey camp to see this head because he'll be dropped in at the back. He'll be ridden cold. He was a little too excited last time in Newbury. Where he is in this particular case, he's race dependent. A little bit like Stateman, he'll be much easier to ride if they go fast, which they normally do in a county hurdle, but it's not a given.
But didn't you always used to tell me, even if you were on a hold-up horse and you wanted to go out the back, you'd still start quite near the front?
Oh, yeah, you have to, not start near the front, but you have to be moving forward. You have to be away swiftly. You know, the start's very important, not to get left on your back heels a little bit, you know.
Now, I know there's no bonus for the Imperial Cup winner coming here, but surprise package was very impressive at Sandown early on Saturday. Gone up, well, he's carrying a £5 penalty.
Yeah, he has, but this is a much deeper race. There's a lot of better horses in here against him.
Did win by 9 lengths. We'll see.
And away they go. So, heading out for the county hurdle. Stepney Causeway, one of the first to show with I Like to Move It. Also Eclair de Beaufort in the front rank with My Mate Mossy as they arrive at flight number one. The Grey Irascible and Booer Boy jump it just behind the leaders. And also just behind these we have Colonel Mustard, Top Bandit with the white bit on his nose. Felix Desgy, Call Me Lyrene towards the outside. It's about midfield, Cormier tanking himself up with Tritonic Tax for Max Broomfield Bergwell back early with Stateman towards the outside in the yellow and black checks as they make their run on towards the second. Stateman is keen early towards the outside of the field. A buried away surprise package, Broomfield Berg and Bally Adam with Favour in that little cluster. West Cork has about 5 behind in these early strides. Tempo Chapter 2 is one of them with Guadalage, Dysart, Diamond, Far Out and Cask Mate. So that's just about the roll call on the run towards the second. Stepney Causeway, I Like to Move It. Eclair de Beaufort and Stepney Causeway slithered on landing there, briefly lost his back end. He doesn't, however, yet lose the lead. So Stepney Causeway under Jack Andrews has the lead narrowly from in second place, Eclair de Beaufort, the leading quartet completed by Booer Boy and I Like to Move It. My Mate Mossy comes next with First Street on the inside of Colonel Mustard, Felix Desgy and Irascible, the grey and the white cap are just behind those with Jesse Evans and also Top Bandit, Call Me Lyrene in midfield with Cormier, Bally Adam and Tritonic as they race on now towards flight number 3, Stepney Causeway. Narrow leader with I Like to Move It, Eclair de Beaufort and Booer Boy. They are the first 4 to arrive at the third. Tritonic takes it just behind the leaders. They are all over safely. Dysart Diamond remains towards the back of the field early on. Next two flights come swiftly. Stepney Causeway, I Like to Move It and Eclair de Beaufort. Good lead by My Mate Mossy moves that one forward. Booer Boy is in fifth and Colonel Mustard in sixth. First Street on the inside of Felix Desgy and Irascible. Stateman still in midfield behind Top Bandit and Cormier. As they take the next, Jesse Evans towards the inside with Tritonic, Call Me Lyrene. Dysart Diamond was slow in rear there and is about 3 lengths off the back end. Guadalage is held up, surprise package Far Out in that rear grouping company as well, with Favoir, who is quite well back. Tempo Chapter 2 likewise, and Cask Mate towards the inside with the yellow cap. So only three flights of hurdles to take, but only just passing halfway. And out in the lead, Stepney Causeway and Eclair de Beaufort, these two disputing the running from I Like to Move It in third place. My mate Mozzie slightly stumbled on landing in fourth. Another mistake at the back by Dysart Diamond. Boua Boy is drifting back in the field, as up on the inside, First Street makes some ground. Colonel Mustard is in about eighth or ninth place at this stage. The grey Irascible is there. Cormier just in midfield, racing on the outside of Jesse Evans. Felix Desgy comes next with Call Me Lyrene. State Man is still in midfield alongside West Cork, then Tritanic, Buddy Adams still towards the back. Tax for Max as they run downhill. Tempo Chapter 2 far out, Guadalage, and still right at the back is Dysart Diamond. So two flights of hurdles to take, Stepney Causeway and Eclair de Beaufort on the descent towards the second last. Still have the initiative, I Like to Move It racing in third. In fourth place, my mate Mozzie, then towards the outside, getting closer is Colonel Mustard. The grey is Irascible, Top Bandit working into it as well. Cormier comes next, hefty fall at the back from Cask Mate, who's a horse and jockey quickly on their feet. Turning for home, Eclair de Beaufort has the lead. Coming out of the pack in second place is Colonel Mustard, Top Bandit away to the right-hand side. My Mozzie tries to improve. Surprise Package and State Man are both making good progress under the near side rail. Action changes now as Colonel Must is taken on by State Man, who travels strongly with Surprise Package. West Cork has stayed on. Then behind these, Top Bandit and Cormier down towards the last. Colonel Mustard out in the centre. State Man looms alongside Surprise Package and West Cork and First Street. State Man jumps to the front at the last and is swiftly away from it. Colonel Mustard, First Street over on the far side is staying on, but it's State Man who's two or three lengths clear from in second, First Street, who is staying on stoutly, but it is State Man, another for Paul Townend and Willie Mullins. First Street, second, Colonel Mustard, West Cork, Bally Adams, Surprise Package, Cormier, Felix Desgy, far out. Then behind those, my mate Mozzie, Tempo Chapter 2 crosses the line, Call Me Lyrene, Jesse Evans, I Like to Move It, and Guadalage. State Man, just too good, swept up on the outside and took the race by the scruff of the neck, almost guaranteeing both Paul Townend and Willie Mullins their titles for the week, certainly for Willie. In second, First Street, third was Colonel Mustard, West Cork fourth, extra places, Bally Adam fifth, Surprise Package sixth, Cormier seventh, my mate Mozzie eighth, far out ninth, and Felix Desgy tenth. Competitive race, but to be honest, when State Man was asked to win it, it was over pretty swiftly.
Yeah, probably a grade one horse running in handicap company. No wonder he's smiling. Bookmakers won't. Nightmare start on the day for the bookmakers, those poor old bookmakers. And just imagine those Mullins accumulators. He can't have more than three or four, can he? We shall see. Great start to the day for Paul Townend.
Thanks, Dave.
Paul, everybody was talking about this horse before. Was he a grade one horse in a handicap? He made it look like that today.
He needed to be to win the ride I gave him, I thought. I was kind of all over the place a little bit on him, but he lacked in experience. I just wanted a clear round on him, clear run, and got there plenty soon on him. But people say you get there too soon and things, but when you win, are you really there too soon?
You keep saying this, you keep giving yourself a hard time at the top of this hill with winners. You seem to be doing a pretty good job. These colours on Album Photo in the big one, he's a horse very close to your heart.
Very much so. We've experienced a lot of emotions with him, every extreme. So please God, we'll be speaking to you again.
Well done.
Thank you.
Good horse, Ruby.
He is, Ed, yeah. Look, he fell at Christmas and in a maiden hurdle and didn't end up running in a maiden hurdle until February, which meant he missed the Dublin Racing Festival. And I think when you got a mark of 141, it was easy enough to decide which way he was going. It was which handicap would you run him in. This is the one that was chosen for him. And as Paul said himself, it was a safe ride, is what it was, a very safe ride around the outside. He got into no trouble at any stage and he had plenty up his sleeve, jumped the last really well. He was probably a bit keen all the way, but look, we thought he was a decent horse and he's gone and delivered. Mind you, halfway up the running, I was thinking, oh my God, number eight is coming flying, First Street. Is he going to get to him? But he didn't, thank God.
Ruby, Ribby, we say the handicaps, this was the chosen one. Had Paul Townend got something to do with that? Martin Pipe wouldn't have been much good to Paul Townend, would it?
No, it wouldn't have been. And 2 miles and five, no way, Pete. But there's no point in being sable jockey if you're going to just give it away to everybody else. And, you know, I can't imagine you'd have given too many rides to the conditions.
I was just going to say, so you knew all about that, didn't you?
I was good at it as well. But, no, look, it was the Coral Cupper here, and I think Paul felt the easier ride him in the county, and he was right.
11 to 4, the favourite. First Street was second at 16 to 1. Ran well. Colonel Mustard ran well as well at 13 to 2. West Cork at 13 to 2 in fourth. Bally Adam at a big price in fifth, 50 to 1 if you had first five, which a number of firms did, and more. So hopefully the finish cleared that up for you. And that's Rachel Robbins on the far side who led up State Man here. Mick.
First three horses home, all novices. All horses who aren't exposed handicappers, all horses who could be running in the novice hurdles but have actually chosen to come down the handicap route. I think we've seen a really nice performance, three nice young horses. You know, the form's backed up really well. A horse in the red colours there is Colonel Mustard. He's got form that ties in with Sir Gerhard and John Bond. And First Street, he was placed in a Betfair hurdle. You know, so he had that little bit of handicap hurdle experience as a novice. But I think this is a really deep race.
You know, probably the best horse like Vauban, but over onto that far rail, I think, is always a help. And you see why Ruby and Paul and all the lads, they always try to get over onto it. It's definitely a help.
And as you say, imagine the Bamfords will be thrilled with First Street for Alice and Lady Bamford and for Nicky Henderson, who's won this a couple of times. 1993 and 97, second this time around. Bally Adams run really well in fifth at a huge price.
He's run a great race. I think they'll be absolutely delighted with that. It's a real return to form for him as well. He was a horse, of course, who was very strongly fancied for the Supreme a couple of years ago.
So we've had the Triumph, we've had the County Hurdle, we have got the Albert Bartlett next after State Man here. Won the County Hurdle heavily back to the 11-4, paid £3.75 on the tote, who match the SP. So far, it's been the Mullins and Townend show once again, and they've got plenty more chances through the afternoon. Brilliant start for the punters here. Another favourite's gone in. State Man back down to 11-4 to win the McCoy Contractors County Hurdle, delivered for that man, Paul Townend, and yet again, Willie Mullins. Oh, that's lovely to see. That's Maureen, Willie's mum. She won't thank me for saying it, but she's 92 years young. The matriarch, really. I mean, what a dynasty she has created. Successful Mullinses everywhere, as we saw yesterday. Quite something, the Mullins dynasty, fair to say, with Maureen here.
Unbelievable, you know, Willie Mullins, like, that's Johnny Murtagh, that great piece of, you know, advice
analysis,
that he,
that's analysis, top analysis,
gives.
The text and said he's a good trainer.
Willie Mullins is a good trainer, but by God, he is some trainer. Every kind of a horse. I know that he hasn't won the Melbourne Cup, Max Dynamite finish, but every kind of a race, every kind of trip, every kind of ground.
What a beautiful sight that is off the Falcon camera.
So let's catch up at this stage with our standings for the week. We can have a look at the Colin Cooper Leading Jockey Award at the moment, and Paul Townend with five winners. Looks like he won't be for catching. Nico de Boinville with two. Patrick Mullins, of course, son of Willie Mullins, with two. Rachel Blackmore, two as well. And then one apiece for the remainder on the graphic there. And then as we go to the trainers, I can't think how many times Willie Mullins has been champion trainer here, but AP just said probably more times than he hasn't been. So seven wins so far for him. Gordon Elliott would need to win the next five to beat him. That's a challenge. Nicky Henderson, two for the week, as has Venetia Williams. Great festival for her, and Henry Bromhead, two as well. Congratulations to all of those on the leaderboard. Now, let's go and find Chris.
Yeah, now the atmosphere really building up before the Cheltenham Gold Cup. Not long to go now. And I asked you all earlier at home, where will you be watching the Gold Cup from this afternoon? All our viewers, and you've been very responsive, as you always are, using that ITV Racing hashtag. Ian. Now, Ian's at home. He's got a great setup. He's got the beer mat set out in front with a Cheltenham Racecourse placemat. Top man. You're watching on the TV, getting your feet up as you should be. Ali, she's got a recuperating dog, Betty Pickle, who had surgery this week, so they're watching together at home. We got Caroline, who's watching at home with her stirrup ice bucket. Now, you've got the right setup. The temperature very warm this afternoon, so enjoy yourself. And we got Kelly Louise. She's at home watching with her family on the rocking horse. So getting the children started early. I love that. Keep getting your responses into us. Use the hashtag ITV Racing. Like I said, the Gold Cup, it's fast approaching. Bet the viewers are going to be packed in front of those TV screens.
There's a bit of debate going on the podium here as to whether Chris Hughes has forgotten to do his hair today or is just trialling a new style. Either way,
like
looking
it?
Great. It's different.
I didn't answer the question.
A bit less groomed, but, you know, maybe we should take a poll. Now, we are long on Gold Cup winning jockeys today, Mick, Ruby and AP alongside us, but Ollie's caught up with another dual winner of the race.
Well, fitting on Gold Cup Day to speak to a Gold Cup legend, Barry Geraghty, a dual winner of the race, and the sun's got its hat on today. How much are you looking forward to the race?
Oh, really am. It's a really competitive race, and I think it's more quality than people are giving it credit for. You know, you've obviously been a Lindo last year's winner, you've Alban Photo twice a winner, after a tired runner-up. So, no, it's strong in quality.
I look at it, and as the market would suggest, you could run it six or seven times and get six or seven different results. Is that how you see it as well?
I think to a degree. For me, the possible lack of pace in the race just posed a little bit of a question. Frodon was the pacemaker last year and made it the test that Manila Indo really relished. I think Galvin would love those conditions, test of stamina. But will it be as strong? If it isn't, it could play a tackle of cards strength, who has a bit of speed.
We had Rachel on the opening show, and obviously he's going to lower the colours to Manila Indo. But just touching on that point, and I said to AP about the lack of pace, he said it's a Gold Cup, they never relent in a Gold Cup. Have you ridden in Gold Cups that aren't as sort of strenuous as perhaps you thought they would be?
Well, for example, Alban Foto's first Gold Cup, they didn't go quick here. As Santini was second, he was a good stayer, but Alban Foto was the speed horse in the day. It can happen. You know, I've ridden against Native River, say, end-to-end gallop, like those years. Kicking King won it, it felt like it was a slow pace, but he was a really classy horse. But I wouldn't imagine they went as quick as they've gone maybe last year with Frodon making the pace, and the years Native River has. If you have a proper quality stayer going forwards, it makes it a big test.
How special was it for you when you won here?
Oh, it's magic. And the whole week builds towards, like, your champion hurdles, champion chases, stayers, Reiner. Amazing races, but the atmosphere today is just a little bit different.
I can't let you go without reflecting on the first race of the week with Constitution Hill winning the Supreme, because you know that horse from essentially birth to when you passed him on to Nicky Henderson. How proud were you of what he did that day?
It was a magic day. Myself and Warren Ewing bought him as a foal. Michael Buckley and Nicky bought him obviously as a four-year-old, but we had him at home for 3 years. I broke him as a two-year-old. Our kids all rode him. And that we've videos and footage and photos and whatnot. So the kids were here with us on Tuesday. It's an amazing day and up there with the best I've had here.
You're going to hate this question, but finally, if Constitution Hill and Honeysuckle were to meet at the end of the season, who would win?
I'm sure I'm biased, but obviously I'd love to see Constitution Hill. He put up an amazing performance, so he's fingers crossed he stays in one piece. He could be a superstar for the future.
You sure could. Well done with the work you've done on him, and great chatting to you as always.
Cheers, thanks, Ali. Thank you.
Great to see Barry, who's been in good form all week. An update for you on Cast Mate, who came down. Dennis Regan looked perfectly right after that fall, and the horse walked into the horse ambulance, so hopefully he is OK. If there's any more news, we shall let you know. Let's go to Ruby in his hub. And, Ruby, how much do you enjoy that camera up in the sky?
You see all sorts of things, Ed, but I was saying Paul Townend gave Stateman a safe ride on the outside, and I'm going to show you why now, because John Joe O'Neill, we're going to pick him up on Broomfield Burg here in a second. When the horses bunch in front of him at the top of the hill approaching the bend before they descend, Broomfield Burg actually clips the heel of Tax from Max in front of him and very nearly goes down. But for our benefit, John Joe was also wearing the jockey cam, so we can see from his angle as well. Doesn't look as bad from through his eyes, but I'd say his heart skipped a beat or two.
Who will win the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup at 3:30? He's on a roll. An Alban Photo's done it twice before. But Manila Indo is back to defend his title for Henry. Stay with us.
big race of the festival.
Cheltenham, Gold Cup Day. Big race.
It is the pinnacle of the atmosphere.
The Cheltenham Gold. It feels like gold.
Gold to me. This is the best we've seen for a long time. Arthur is the winner of the Gold Cup.
We come to the 34th Gold Cup since the war. It's midnight course under a beautiful ride from John Franco.
And looking to emulate Courtois' star by regaining the Gold Cup as Album Photo's got 10 wins on his career record from 20 lifetime starts. He's a lightly raced 10-year-old, but he boasts not one, but two Gold Cups to his name. He gave Willie Mullins that much anticipated first Gold Cup and represents his best chance of claiming a third today in the colours of Mrs. Joe Donnelly.
And he just seems to love the two circuits and what is a helter-skelter course away to the right there. And we're only 50 minutes or so away from the big one. Our build-up will begin after our next race, which is the Albert Bartlett.
And this race at over 3 miles was won by Manella Indo on this very day. 3 years ago, headed by number one Ballygriffin Cottage for Harry Skelton, over 3 miles. This is the more dour types that we see, but they've been getting pretty well on the ground today. So Harry and Dan Skelton, Ballygriffin Cottage 2 is Bardenstown Lad, Sean Bowen, the first of the Irish runners for trainer John McConnell. Number three is Brawson for Jamie Moore and local trainer Martin Keithley, colours of David Moore. Number four, Classic Getaway, an expensive purchase, Cheaply Park Stud, Patrick and Willie Mullins. Five is Eric Bloodaxe, JJ Slevin for Joseph O'Brien. Six at absentee, so seven, Ginto is next. Gordon Elliott, we heard, needs to land the next five to catch Willie Mullins. The only one with all representatives in the race is left. Jack Kennedy writes, leading chance. Eight, Good Time Johnny, Kevin Sexton for Tony Martin in the striped colours of red and green. Number nine is Green Book. It's been a great week so far for Charlie Deutsch and Venetia Williams. They team up here with a horse that's been backed at long odds. Number 10 is Hillcrest, the gentle giant who's progressed so well this year. Richard Patrick for Henry Daly, colours of the late Trevor Hemmings. 11 an absentee, Ida's Boy. Number 12 is Marla Mission, James Bowen, a second for John McConnell. 13 is Manella Kakuna, Paul Townend, and Willie Mullins, the combination. David Bobbitt is the owner. 14 is Ramillies in the Donnelly colours that Paul Townend rode in. In our previous race, this time it's Brian Cooper. Willie Mullins, 14, Ramillies. 15 is Sean Truss, Rachel Blackmore riding for Henry de Bromhead in the quartered colours of orange and black. 16, Staghorn. Associate Archie Watson, more with flat horses, but two from two, Staghorn and to Nick Schofield for Ben and Sir Martin are B. 17 is The Nice Guy, Malcolm Denmark's colours, checkered flag with the yellow sleeves. Sean O'Keefe, another for Willie Mullins. 18 doesn't go, which means 19. Where it all began is where it all ends, last of them. But Adrian Heskin and Gordon Elliott. So absentees, they are number 6, 11 and 18, 16 for this year's Albert Bartlett.
And Hillcrest is so important for so many punters. Those big bets that go in. Star Sports had 120 grand on Vovin. They lost that. That was a big loss. They've had 125 grand on Hillcrest at 2-1. Ginto at 5-2. Minella Kakuna at 11-2. Chantreuse at 12. Good Time Johnny at 14. Staghorn, the good flat horse, at 18. The Nice Guy at 18. Speaking of which, let's go to one.
You can see the first two favourites have gone in. This is John Hughes, significant bookmaker here this week at Cheltenham. He's paying out 45,120 on Stateman in the county hurdle. We all on Stateman. And they're rolling it up here. Ginto, 9-4 each of two with Hillcrest. Although one punter on the rails has had 50 grand on Hillcrest. And he was the same punter that had 50 grand on Vauban at 13-8. Manella Kakuna, 5-1. And it's 12-1 bar. But Hillcrest and Ginto, the bookmakers, will want those two beaten.
Come on!
Well, very rarely do you see 16 runners in a Grade 1. And this Grade 1 three-miler is the first in England or Ireland over hurdles of the season. A lot of these horses haven't gone the distance with this many runners. And the Irish have got a huge contingent here. 12 of the 16 are Irish. But that said, I'm going to start with the English because this is Hillcrest. And we all talk about big horses, but this horse, look at him. He's absolutely enormous. He probably stands at about 17 hands high. Trained by Henry Daly. Beautiful, big, black, imposing horse by Stowaway. And in those famous colours of the great, late Trevor Hemmings, he would be an extremely popular winner. Here's number 7. This is Ginto, really fancied. He's looking hit for his 4th win on the bounce for Gordon Elliott. He steps up in trip today. He's class. Look how different he is from the old Hillcrest. He's not a small horse, but he looks like a pony behind him. Here's number 19. This is right at the bottom, where it all began. One of two for Gordon Elliott. And he's a busy horse. He's not one that particularly strikes. He just doesn't do anything wrong. He's got a good, positive attitude. Here's number 16, and I really wanted you to see him, because if we saw the great, big Hillcrest, this is little tiny Staghorn. And you see, when I stand into him, he's very different. Archie Watson's made a massive name for himself on the flat, but he's done a brilliant job with this little Staghorn. He was a very good flat horse and now shaping into a very smart hurdler. He is getting warm, boys. Not sure if that's a worry.
Well, I'm not sure whether Henry Daly's a huge fan of the opening show, but if he wasn't watching this morning, he would know that one person on the panel was suggesting that Hillcrest is going to take all the beating today, because one person on the panel is in love with him, and that's me. Now, how is he, and how do you feel about his chances today?
He's fine. I'm thrilled that we had the rain on Wednesday. It's worked, really, that it's nice, safe ground. You know, that's what we want, and I'm absolutely thrilled. And he's in good order. Look, it was only 3 or so weeks ago that we ran at Haydock. It's not ideal, but I couldn't be happier with him at this stage.
Regardless of what happens today, regardless of what he's done so far, one thing that you've not hidden is your admiration for his talent from a very, very early stage. What is it about what he's been doing that excites you?
Well, as much as anything, he's got the most fantastic attitude. I would be surprised, but I think he's probably the only horse in here with a rug on. He is so relaxed about it all, and yet competitive, that he's perfectly cool and calm and collected, unlike you, obviously.
Yes, and I'm a little bit edgy now.
You know, it's a huge advantage to have a horse with a good attitude, with that sort of calmness. It makes such a difference.
I hope you don't mind me saying, but I was earwigging it as I was coming to ask you for the interview. I heard you looked up at the board and saw that he was 2-1, which is extraordinary considering the strength of the opposition. What are your thoughts on who you're facing up against?
Well, I think they're all nuts. I mean, honestly, he's an 18-hand chaser who's hurdling, and he's 2-1. Well, I mean, look, I'd be thrilled if he won. I just hope he runs really well, and then I'll be chuffed.
A lot of people will be thrilled if he won. Henry, best of luck.
Thank you very much.
I'd ignore that, just like his former boss, Captain Forster, typically pessimistic. He hasn't had a winner at the Festival Henry since 2003. He's been driving here each day in a Mini on his social media. Hillcrest might be a Rolls Royce. And there he is, the giant Hillcrest. too tall for Henry's measuring stick. But over 18 hands, he's the 2-1 favourite. Jumping, is that the worry with this horse, AP?
I don't know, he was a little unlucky here when he unseated. There's only time here at Cheltenham. But yeah, he's a really beautiful looking big stamp of a horse. He'd walk around there and he is a real pick. He was a little bit excited, but he looks cool going to the start. There's a lot to like him. He, as you said about Captain Foster, Henry Daly's old boss, he would love this horse. You know, he's got a lot to like about him. I think Jinto is a big player, though. He walked around the parade ring. He was really calm. He looked a real cool dude walking around. You know, I really like Jinto.
It's a real Britain against Irish clash, this. The Brits seem to love this horse. There's real confidence, Mick, from the Irish behind Jinto, as AP just said.
Yeah, he won that Lawlers of Nace, which is always a really good pointer over 2.5 miles. It's a grade one. He certainly didn't look like a horse that wouldn't benefit from the step up in trip. I don't think he needed to go up in trip. I just think they thought, well, this could be the easier option, so let's take it. He's a smart horse, and I think he is a... You know, he is a very, very worthy opponent for Hillcrest.
Although, if you look at the prices of recent winners of this race, last year 14-1, year before 5-1, before that 50-1, that was Manella Indo, 33-1, 16-1. It's been a bit of a race for the outsiders.
It's a race, actually, that progressive handicappers have done well in the past, Francesca. I actually like Good Time Johnny, who won a handicap last time for Tony Martin. I think he has got a good profile for this race.
The one the bookmakers really will not want to win here, Ruby, is Minlela Kakuna. Would stamina be the question about him?
I would think so, Ed, and you also have to settle. He raced quite keenly at the Dublin Racing Festival with Danny Mullins, where he jumped brilliantly, but he did race a bit on with the chokeout, is what we would say, which means that they're overusing energy, and he'll have to settle better if he's going to get this trip this afternoon. Willie has a couple of more Patrick rides, classic getaway in the Cheveley Park colours there in your shot, red, white sash and the blue cap. Now, he's a very expensive horse, but has yet to live up to it. And the grey outside him in the Donnelly colours, the yellow and black, is Ramelay. I think he's a squeak. He won well on his last start. Ran well on last year's champion bumper. If Brian Cooper takes his time on him, he could run a good race.
Beautiful picture that with the crowd in the background. What's happening, Luke?
Do you know what, Matt? This is the most difficult start for everybody concerned because the crowd, it's deafening down here. Normally these starts, it's all so quiet. But they're just a little bit early. They've just been told to take a turn. There's a few of them down. Staghorn was down here very early. But look at them. They'll turn in a second. All the jockeys, if you notice, they'll all be just chatting away to each other, saying, what are you going to do on that fella? What are you going to do on that? And they'll say, well, don't worry about mine. Mine goes right. But look at the crowds in the background there. It's an extraordinary sight.
Oh, it's a real good betting heat down here, Luke. Each of two, 9-4 Hillcrest, 9-4 Jinto. Just as I speak, they've pushed out Jinto to 5-2 to try and get the last few quid into the satchel. 125,000 at 9-4 on Hillcrest in the office in London with Star Sports. 25,000 here on track in cash at 9-4. On the screen, it's on 9-4 each of two, but you can get 5-2, the Irish horse on track.
So they've gone a long, long way back off the starter here. They would still be best part of a furlong away from the start. Crowd looking on as we count down to the Gold Cup. I mentioned Manella Indo did the Albert Bartlett Gold Cup double. And this race has thrown up plenty of very, very smart horses that have gone on to good staying success. Little Staghorn's on the inside, the yellow colours. Completely different looking horse to the majority of his rivals here. You only have to go side on to be able to see how much lower his rider is. He's showing it off, but he's a much smaller horse. You can see his backside there, not anywhere near as big. And Nick Scofield looks as if he's going to be prominent. Approaching the starter. The flag is raised, so this will be hopefully the final approach. It can be wide here. They're breaking into a little bit fast. The starter's not going to like this. He's going to be yelling at them. I don't think this is where they go.
And Mick, that falls into the category where you always ask the question, why do they start so far back?
I really don't get it. I think you're asking for trouble. If you have them that far back, of course they're going to try and get going. The ones on the outside don't want the ones on the inside to get a run on them. So they're always going to be looking across saying, oh, are they going, are they going? You're just asking for trouble. Start them and get them to come forward a little bit closer to the tail.
Ruby?
Yeah, but it's space as well, Ed. I mean, the track's not wide enough there. The outside rail is too close to the inside rail. Not every horse can even line up in the front row from where they walk from. So the track is just too narrow there, and everybody wants to be in the front to get a good position. It's wide enough when they get round the bend, but when they're on the bend, it's not wide enough.
A reminder, the way they do it, jig-jogging, is designed for fairness and a level playing field. Let's hope it works this time.
They're off, he let them go. I wasn't sure we were going to. Bally Griffin Cottage was a little bit out the back, and Brawson was caught back on his heels on the outside as they race towards the first. It's a good pace for a staying race early on. Little Staghorn up there in company with Barden's Town Lad, Classic Getaway and Chantreuse as they arrive at flight number one. And they're all over, but Ramillies, the grey, was very slow in midfield, rather impeded Good Time Johnny, who wasn't too great either. So the order, Staghorn and Classic Getaway are the first two to rise at flight number two. Manila Kakuna on the outside of the quartered colours of Chantreuse, and they are the front quartet. White face towards the inside, Barden's Town Lad, ahead of Ginto in the white and green with the red cap. As they pop over that, Brawson has made midfield, a Marla Mission, the pale blue colours, is also in midfield early on. The check colours of the Nice Guy, and then the grey Ramillies, who's been sent forward after that error at the first. They're being followed by Where It All Began. At this stage, Hillcrest is quite well back in the field towards the inside as they head on towards the fourth in the quartered colours of yellow and green. The early pace appears to have been reasonable enough. And then behind these, we have Eric Bloodaxe, who's about four from the back. And Hillcrest wasn't great there. Green Book, Good Time Johnny, and Bally Griffin Cottage is last of all. So Big Hillcrest just taking a little bit of time to warm to his task. He's two-thirds of the way back through the field, one error to his name, and hasn't quite found his rhythm. He is just labouring a little bit. Ruby, if things haven't gone according to plan, or maybe Hillcrest is just finding this tempo at this stage at least a little faster than he's used to.
Yeah, but the first three furlongs, Richard, were quicker than the opening three in the Triumph Hurdle, and the horse on the outside, Manila Kakuna with the hood, is actually pushing Classic Getaway forward, who's pushing Staghorn forward. So they are going quite hard because the two of Willie Mullins' runners haven't settled.
So all is not lost for those at the back when stamina kicks in if they are going a little fast up front. So Staghorn, Manila Kakuna, as Ruby mentioned, keen on the outside, a Classic Getaway between the pair. Again, though, Hillcrest paddled through it. And Richard Patrick just pushing along. One of the horses lost a shoe in the background there. Either Green Book or possibly Good Time Johnny. As they turn, it's Staghorn on the outside of Classic Getaway and Manila Kakuna. They're the front three. Brawson has made ground through the field in those stripes of red and white to sit in fourth. Ginto's always been handy towards the inside, races in fifth with Chantreuse and Marla Mission. Nice Guy finishes in about seventh place at this stage, racing on the outside of Barden's Town Lad. Then behind these, the grey Ramillies. Hillcrest on the inner of Where It All Began, and four behind for Good Time Johnny, Eric Bloodaxe, Green Book and Bally Griffin Cottage. As a Getaway led them over that flight, at which on the inside Staghorn was a little bit slow. So turning away from the stands, just getting a chance to gather their breath here. Classic Getaway pressed again though by Manila Kakuna. Staghorn and Brawson are the front quartet as they move away. Fifth is Ginto, just ahead of Chantreuse. And then the Nice Guy on the outside of Marla Mission. Ramillies comes next with Hillcrest. Towards the inside, Barden's Town Lad has lost a little bit of ground. Eric Bloodaxe is still in that rear group in company with Where It All Began, Good Time Johnny, Bally Griffin Cottage and Green Book. So six flights to take, three of which will be in the next three furlongs. And on the outside, Manila Kakuna of Classic Getaway and Brawson. Manila Kakuna continues to press on and jumps that well. Leading now by a couple of lengths. From in second, Brawson, Classic Getaway is third as they head on towards the next. Staghorn is just struggling to hold his place with Ginto on his inside, Chantreuse on the outer. Manila Kakuna guessed at that. There was a full stride on landing as well. Hillcrest back in the field is having to be ridden along but is trying to make ground amongst horses. So Manila Kakuna gave Paul Town into fright at that flight, and he's over in the lead from Brawson, Chantreuse. Ginto is in fourth. Staghorn with the improving the Nice Guy. Classic Getaway is beaten, dropping back swiftly as the grey Ramillies tries to improve. And at the back of the field, I think Hillcrest might be about to be pulled up. Hillcrest are being eased down. Classic Getaway, pretty sure Hillcrest is going to call it a day off the back there with Classic Getaway another. And both of those two pulled up. Hillcrest never really found them going. So out in the lead, it's Brawson, who's joined Manila Kakuna on the run towards the third last. Ginto is in third place, then Chantreuse, fifth place for the Nice Guy making ground. A mistake by Where It All Began. Ramillies is closing in sixth. Marla Mission comes next from Barden's Town Lad. Good Time Johnny. Bally Griffin Cottage from a long way back has been given a patient ride by Harry Scott. Skelton is just picking off a few as they run downhill on the inside of Green Book. So the leading group is made up of as many as a dozen horses as they're heading down towards the second last in the Albert Bartlett. Manella Kakuna on the outside of Brawson, then towards the inside, Ginto's Red Cap. Chantreurs, the nice guy in the yellow sleeves, Bartonstown Lad and Marla Mission. Behind these, pushed along is Good Time Johnny. Bally Griffin Cottage continues to make ground. White Jacket towards the outer, gone past Green Book as they head down towards the second last flight of hurdles. Out in the lead, Manella Kakuna, Chantreurs on the outside, then towards the inside is Brawson. The nice guy comes next. Ginto now angles out amongst horses. Behind these is Ramillies. Marla Mission comes next, and Bally Griffin Cottage and Good Time Johnny on the turn for home. Ginto travelling strongly on the back of Brawson. Out in the lead, Manella Kakuna is there to be taken. Ginto's gone wrong. Ginto's taken a full step with every chance, I'm afraid, has suffered a nasty injury on the run down towards the last. Manella Kakuna within second place, the nice guy. Then back in third place is Ramillies. Bally Griffin Cottage into fourth. Manella Kakuna with on the outside, the nice guy coming to challenge as they race up towards the last flight of hurdles. It is the nice guy racing up on the outside of Manella Kakuna. The two are over in the air together. It's the nice guy for Sean O'Keefe. Manella Kakuna for Paul Townend. A Willie Mullins 1-2 with Bartonstown Lad back in third. But it's the nice guy who is going to make it 4 out of 4. This nice guy doesn't finish second. And the nice guy for Sean O'Keefe and Willie Mullins wins the Albert Bartlett. In second, Manella Kakuna. In third, Bartonstown Lad, Bally Griffin Cottage. Then behind these was Green Book. In sixth place was Ramillies. In seventh behind those was Brawson. Thoughts with the connections of Ginto, who appeared to be coming to win his race there and sadly has suffered a serious injury on the run down towards the last and is being attended to on the race course. Does take the edge off the nice guy who made it 4 out of 4. Manella Kakuna was in there pitching for quite a long time, just to confirm Bartonstown Lad has finished in third place. Another success then for Willie Mullins does mean he is the leading trainer of the week. And his rider salutes the crowd. Manella Kakuna, who was a little keen in first place, hung on into second. Bartonstown Lad in third, as I say, but thoughts with connections there of Ginto. Heartbreaking stuff.
Well, Sean O'Keefe, your first Grade One, your second festival win. What a place to bag the big one.
Yeah, you couldn't do in a better place to get your first Grade One winners. It's great.
This little horse, he travelled great. It was a war of attrition. It went hard early.
Yeah, he's a lovely horse. He's actually very relaxed. And the further I was going, the more he was actually travelling, the more he was liking it. And I knew at the top of the hill that I was going well. And it's like, and I was very happy, like he jumped great and everything, and like he's still very inexperienced, so it's a great performance from the horse.
And great to be part of the Willie Mullins machine at such a young age.
Yeah, it's great. You know, I'm very, very grateful for the opportunities that Willie's given me and the owners to put faith in me to ride the horses. You know, so I'm forever grateful for that, and just delighted to get the winners for them too.
Sean O'Keefe, Grade One winning jockey.
Thank you.
Good boy, well done.
And congratulations to him and the Monseigneur colours of Malcolm Denmark as well. Kate Tracy actually led up this horse. There she is. Well done to Kate. Familiar face on podcasts and other productions. And this is the Willie Mullins show today. But in truth, that was hard to watch. Spoilt by Ginto breaking down so badly. You have to feel for Gordon Elliott, Jack Kennedy, Bective Stud and Charlotte Crozier, who looks after Ginto. That wasn't good, rather spoilt the finish, dominated by Willie Mullins yet again.
Do you know what? When you're part of the Mullins team, you've got a chance because there is such strength in depth. And, you know, Willie Mullins is a man you need on your side. And Sean O'Keefe was delighted that he was part of that team this afternoon.
I don't think this one would have been in too many multiples, though. And wouldn't have been in too many ITV7 lists as well, with over 500,000 of you playing today for £500,000 on the ITV7. Liam, who won 100 grand on Tuesday, spoke to him a minute ago. There was a 9-1 winner at Donny, and he had it. He had 3 out of 3, would you believe? I doubt he had the winner of the Albert Bartlett, though. The nice guy. Big moment for Sean O'Keefe, AP.
Big moment for Sean O'Keefe. Nothing like riding a winner at the Cheltenham Festival, you know, besides Manila Cooner here. As Mick said, when you're in Willie Mullins, as you could be, you know, you can nearly be sweeping the yard and you have a chance of getting on a good horse, you know. An amazing, amazing trainer, very lightly raced. Not many lightly raced horses win this race, only had the one run over hurdles. but that's why the trainer is different.
And Ruby, they've always thought a bit of him.
Yeah, he keeps surprising his head. I mean, he won a bumper. We didn't think he'd win a winner's bumper, but he did go and win a winner's bumper. He was good in his maiden hurdle at Nace, and he just only ever does enough. And Sean was very good on him. He didn't tackle Paul too early. He kept a good hold of his head all the way down to the last hurdle. Just got in front, going to it. The horse jumped the well. Manila Cooner jumped back beside him, but having raced quite keenly, Manila Cooner was always going to struggle the last furlong of the race, and the nice guy has saw it out really well. Good winner for Sean, got a big chance in Enagramine early in the year when he won the Hilly Way, and of course he won the Martin Pipe here last year on Gallop in the Shop.
Welcome Denmark, coolest man at Cheltenham. Those famous colours winning again here, the rest just a little bit muted at the moment. The nice guy winning at 18-1, slightly bigger dividend on the tote. A 1-2 for Willie Mullins with Manila Cooner second at 9-2. When we come back after this, the Albert Bartlett, our build-up begins to the 2022 Bootles Cheltenham Gold Cup. They say nice guys don't succeed. Mr. Nice Guy has won here at Cheltenham. Huge moment in the career of young Sean O'Keefe. 3 out of 3 for Willie Mullins as we go from St. Patrick's Day to St. William's Day here so far. There he is with his back to us. He will be champion trainer for a 9th time here at the Cheltenham Festival. No great surprise there. Congratulations to Malcolm Denmark and his team. I saw Mark Pittman in amongst them today. As we go to Ruby.
Yeah, I was blaming Ed Manila Cooner's pulling for his weakening in the last furlong, but actually, when you look back at the mistake he made in the back straight, he did really well to recover at all with Paul Townend. He was obviously making the run of a watch, where he stands here way too far back off the hurdle and lands on the top of it, gets his feet out through it. See, Paul ends up in the saddle for a stride or two, but that had to have left his mark at the end of the race too.
People starting to make their way to the pre-parade and the paddock to see the horses ahead of the Gold Cup. There's Kate Tracy, as I say. She helped out the Mullins team last year. Behind closed doors, there's Jackie Mullins on the left. Malcolm Denmark in the glasses. Now we'll keep you up to date with news on the horses that fell and Jinto who broke down. We'll keep our fingers crossed. But that didn't look good for Jinto at all, unfortunately. But we will let you know as soon as we hear any more.
Well, here I am with Malcolm Denmark after the success of a brilliant performance from the Nice Guy. I'm just going to get this gentleman. I'm guessing
my son, Callum.
Yes, because I didn't get a chance to ask you your name because I saw you celebrating alongside your dad. Absolutely magical. Just tell me what it means to be back in the winner's enclosure once again.
Well, it's been 21 years, and 21 years ago, Callum was at school and couldn't see it. So I've been trying to have winners ever since, and it's taken us 21 years to have a winner.
But it's
a wonderful thing. Callum, I saw your celebrations, if you don't mind. It was wonderful to watch. Just describe what you were going through in the closing stages.
It's just what we've been dreaming of all this time. You know, it's just, it's incredible. You know, there's nowhere else. People talk about over National Hunt, people talk about other places. There's just nowhere like Cheltenham. You know, it's just, it's unreal, you know, it's great.
And now that you've had the experience and he's had the experience, but with that 21-year gap, what did that do to you whilst you were waiting to come back here and be back in this spot?
There's so many knocks, there's so many disappointments, and I've had so many nice horses which just unfortunately haven't, just for whatever reason, they've not gone on.
Just in case people don't know, one of the great horses potentially of all time was Monsignor. We never saw him fulfill all that potential.
No, we didn't. And I remember standing here and somebody was thrusting a betting slip into my hand and saying, oh, they're offering you, I think it was 6-1 he was going to win the Gold Cup in the next 5 years or something.
Never run again was unbelievable.
To watch Best Mate go on and do what he did, and you know, to think you beat him round Sandown in the Tolworth and things like that, you know, it's look, I'm not taking anything away, you never know, you know, but he was, Monsignor was bought by this man over here, John Costello, to be a chaser, not to win his champion bumper and to win his Sun Alliance, you know. It's
but this guy has just done nothing but improve. He's very simple. I think his name actually portrays him. Yeah. He is a nice guy. Yeah. If he was a human being, he'd be a nice guy.
It's only his second run over fences, remember. You know, like, sorry, over hurdles. Only his second run over hurdles, remember. Like, well, could be anything, you know.
Well, let's hope.
Yes,
let's hope.
Who knows?
Okay, we won't say it. We won't say it.
Today's
but let's hope that you'll be back here before long. Well, very
thank
well
you
done.
Very much. Thank
great
you very
to
much.
See you here in the winners' enclosure. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And just to give you an update on the trainer, Willie Mullins. He's now had 8 winners at the meeting, equaling his previous best tally of 8. He's on course for a record 9th leading trainer at the Festival Award. And he's already won 3 races today and has got really good chances in the remaining 4. Imagine that. Back out to Chris.
So now with a feature race fast approaching, it's best get out and about, ask our punters who they fancy, and what better place to start here in the best mate enclosure, 3-time winner of the Cheltenham Gold Cup, an absolute legend. So guys, who wins a big race?
Manella Indo.
And for you, my friend?
And go for Carl Venn.
A loser! Rachel Chappell!
Come on! Protected her!
Protected
her!
So we're fancy number 1, Album Photo, maybe an each way bet.
And we will be back in Santini.
Tornado Flyer.
Galvin.
We're going for Galvin. Come on.
Galvin.
A plus Todd.
All right.
A plus Todd. Galvin.
Tornado Flyer.
All right.
All right. You're right, John.
I am going for Tornado Flyer.
And I am going for Santini.
So we're the Hipcats at Cheltenham, and we're going to go for Galvin in the Gold Cup.
And who are you going for at home? Let's get details then on the big one.
So these are the runners and riders for the feature race of the week here. It is the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup, a Grade 1 contest over 3 miles, 2.5 furlongs. Album Photo, bidding to win it for the 3rd time, would be only the 2nd horse to ever regain a Gold Cup. He won it in 2019-2020. Willie Mullins now leading trainer of the week, Bull Town End currently leading rider. 2 is Aplutar, last year's runner-up, Rachel Blackmore for Henry de Bromhead, Cheveley Park Stud. Rachel stayed loyal to this horse last year when Midorendo won. 3 is Asterion for Lond, the talented but incident-ridden grey. Brian Cooper for Willie Mullins, colours of Mrs. J. Donnelly. Black Cat will be worn by Asterion for Lond. 4 is I Write for the North. 3rd in a handicap here. What a horse he is. Great day for Harriet Graham and Gary Rutherford to have a horse in the Gold Cup. Callum Bewley, big day for him, as it is for owners, long-standing owners, Jeff and Elspeth Adam. 5 is Chantry House, won at the festival 12 months ago. Nico de Boinville for Nicky Henderson in those McManus hoops. Number 5, Chantry House. Number 6 is Galvin, Davy Russell and Gordon Elliott in the colours of Ronnie Bartlett that have been successful this week. Davy stood down yesterday, back in the saddle today on a horse that won the National Hunt Chase at the meeting 12 months ago. Reigning champion is number 7, Manella Indo, already won on this day in the Albert Bartlett. Then in the Gold Cup, Robbie Power has the mount this time around. Number 8 is Protectorat, Sir Alex Ferguson and the Hales, along with Jeb Mason, Harry and Dan Skelton. Yellow colours, the red cap, so impressive in the many clouds. Number 9, Royal Pagai, could have done with even more rain. Charlie Deutsch and Venetia Williams have had an excellent week, and the Riches were on the board earlier on with Vauban. Number 10 is Santini, runner-up in 2020. He deserves a big race success. Polly Gundry has him these days. Nick Schofield aboard. He can be lazy, certainly talented. And number 11, Tornado Flyer, rounds them off for Danny and Willie Mullins, the winner of the King George when he came off a strong pace. And remember, years ago, he finished 3rd in the bumper at the festival as well. 11 runners for this year's centrepiece, the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup, 3.25 miles.
And Protectorat runs in the colours of the Hales family, but you'll recognise that man on the left and the man in the foreground as well. Nick Skelton on the left now and Sir Alex on the right. He just loves being here, does Sir Alex Ferguson. Good luck to them with Protectorat. What is the market saying, boys?
So they tried to give Plutard away at 5-2 in the ring, but is now out to 11-4. A Plutard. They didn't have many takers at the 5-2. A horse who was well back this morning. Galvin at 7-2, that's pretty steady. One or two bookmakers going threes. Al Boom Photo, arguably the best backed horse in the 2022 Gold Cup. The previous dual winner at 6.5 from around 12-1. Al Boom Photo. Minella Indo at 13-2. The King George winner, Tornado Flower at 9. Protector Act from Aintree at 11. Chantry House, Nico de Bonneville saying all this dry weather is in his favour at 16. Royal Pagar needed mud, it's not muddy, 16. Asterion Falange doesn't really often get round, 25-1. Santini's been placed before at 50. And I write's absolutely crucial because he might just be the pace in the race. The outsider at 80-1. 11-4. A Plutard for the Gold Cup run.
Oh, yes, the blue ribbon, the countdown is on, Matt. Great atmosphere here in the betting ring. 177-1 triple for Team Mullins, and he's got a duo in the Gold Cup. Al Boom Photo, 12-1 this morning. You can see here on the rails now, 6-1, Al Boom Photo. At Plutard is 11-4, Galvin 7-2, a 20 grand bet on Manila Indo at 13-2, and a 30 grand bet on At Plutard. What's going to win, guys?
Here in the pre-parade, normally there's nobody here, but everybody's come to see these Gold Cup runners. And two ladies who've got a huge day ahead of them, Harriet Graham here. I write, Harriet, you saddled him down in the stables. How is he?
He's great. He's just taking it all in. We're just standing him here to keep him cool. Elspeth, the owner of him, is just giving him a few kisses and cuddles.
Massive day for you. Good luck.
Absolutely.
And here we've got Santini. He's finished second in the race before, but Polly Gundry has taken him on from Nicky Henderson, freshened him up. We saw him finish second in the Cotswold Chase. Polly, how are the nerves?
Good, fine. Yeah.
I hear you've got. He's managed to lose 15 kilos since we last saw him.
That's right. Yeah, he has. Yeah. No, I'm busy playing with ponies, so I'm fine now.
Good girl. Two outsiders, but don't overlook them.
We're set. Here are the contenders then for Jump Racing's most coveted trophy. Al Boom Photo's done it twice before. Last year's hero, Manella Indo. Can Gordon Elliott win the Gold Cup? He wasn't here last year, he was suspended. Or will Protectorat win it for the British? We're about to find out. Brilliant to have you with us at home ahead of one of the big races in the calendar, the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup. For the first time ever, they're watching in America. You're all very, very welcome. Hope you enjoy it as we go to Alice.
This place is literally heaving. Everybody wants to get a look at these. They've moved through from the pre-parade ring, and we're better placed to start in a Gold Cup than with the King George winner. Here he is, Tornado Flyer. How incredible was Danny Mullins yesterday? He broke his neck, had 3 months off, Danny, came back in October, has done the most extraordinary rehab programme you can imagine to get fit for days like this and rides like this. He's an extraordinary rider. Stephen Cahill's done a great job leading him up. Massive day for Danny. He's cool as a cucumber, though. Here's number 4, I write. We had a look at him in the stables. He's the big outsider, but what a huge day for a tiny team that trained just 6 horses, and here they are on the biggest stage of them all. Number 5, Chantry House. Have to say, Nicky Henderson's had better chances, I would suggest, in the Gold Cup. But Chantry House has always been a horse that's filled the eye and always been a horse that he's believed in. We saw him at the Cotswold Chase, and to be honest, at the end, he did look a little bit empty, but he's here and he's fit and ready to roll. Manella Indo, well, what a returning champ. Credit to the De Bromhead team that every single horse we've seen here has been immaculately turned out. And this lad, he's 2 from the track. He's 1-2-1 at the festival. No, his form hasn't been so good since, but something about this place lights him up. And let's have a look at Santini. You've got to stand into this boy when you see him. Boys, look, you'll be pleased to see he's stripped an awful lot fitter than when we saw him at the Cotswold Chase. They've been riding him twice a day. Polly Gundry, who now trains him, champion ace, lady point-to-point jockey. And this is a massive opportunity for her. She's always believed in this horse, even when Nicky didn't before he got him. And now here she is, with him lining up in the Gold Cup under her name.
And as the jockeys come out, Paul Townend with that famous trophy. 52 people are left in the ITV7, going for £500,000. Good luck, everybody.
There's only two legs left, and there is Rachel in the Cheveley Park colours. And if you watch the opening show this morning, Francesca, it was very obvious she feels she's got unfinished business in the Gold Cup.
Yeah, so that's a good question to Ruby, isn't it? How does she make amends for last year, where she finished second on Aputard to Manella Indo? And also, Ruby, is he unusual, this horse, in that he's super talented, but he doesn't seem to ever put one win after another?
Yeah, that is unusual. I don't know, does she make amends, though, Francesca? I'm not sure everything went right for a Blue Tar in last year's Gold Cup. And take it from the start. I mean, he starts off beside Album Photo, going to the first fence, but from being just in front of him, he lands just marginally behind him. So that's one little bit. At the second fence, he's gotten behind Album Photo, but he lands further back. There's two. When he gets it back around to that last fence, he loses even more ground than Album Photo here with a stuttery jump. And then early in at the middle ways down the back straight, he makes quite a significant mistake. Watch Rachel's hands as she slips the reins and drifts onto the horse's back. Now, this is the most significant interference for her. Black Op rolls in, cuts the snot off a Blue Tar, and he runs out of ground. And then by the time they get down to the last fence again, just as he's closing a Manila Indo, another stuttery jump. There's five or six things there that could show me that a Blue Tar can improve to win this year's race.
Wouldn't it be amazing if she could add a Gold Cup to that Grand National from last season? Wasn't it odd seeing Paul Townend, in a way, carrying out the Gold Cup, and Jack Kennedy, last year's victorious jockey, sat in the weighing room? No ride in a Gold Cup this time around. Down to Rishi.
Well, Dan Skelton knows what it's like to be in the winner's enclosure after the Gold Cup with the likes of Quarter and Denman. How special is it to have your own runner here in the Gold Cup in Protectorat?
It's very important and special, and we're, you know, delighted to be giving it our best shot. It's going to be very difficult. I think the ground just holds on for us. I wouldn't want to be running tomorrow the way the ground's dried out. I'd say without Wednesday's rain, we would have had absolutely no chance, but I think the ground is just OK.
Of all the principals in the race, he's the youngest at the age of seven. Does it naturally mean, therefore, that he's open to more improvement than some of the others?
Yeah, in theory, but there's a big difference between theory and reality. So I'll stick with the theory for now, and hopefully it turns into it.
How are the nerves?
Fine, absolutely fine. Well, I can't do anything about it. You know, Harry's out there, he knows what he's doing. Hopefully we get a nice clear round, and if we turn in with a chance, what will be.
Best of luck.
Cheers.
Now, they'll sort themselves out for the parade. Let's get selections from our panel and who they'd like to ride most. AP, you go first.
Probably Galvin. I think he's the solid horse in the race. Look, I think, Ruby, you know, we're talking about it tactically. It could be a very different race this year. Album Photo might be more forward. Manila Indo's horse that was ridden handy. Blue Tar, you know, it's for Rachel Blackmore, it's not going to be easy, because when do you challenge whatever's leading to the last? It's going to be a fascinating race.
From one Gold Cup winning jockey to another, Mick Fitzgerald.
Galvin.
With great certainty, to another Gold Cup winning jockey, Ruby Walsh.
I go for that Blue Tar, Ed. As AP says, where's the pace going to come from? I think Album Photo with a pair of cheap pieces on him will go forward. I imagine Manila Indo will go with him. But I'd still be on a Blue Tar. I think there was enough in last year's race to suggest, with any bit of luck, he could win this time round.
Doesn't often happen that a horse beaten in a Gold Cup comes back and win it. Could that happen? And there's Galvin, who's gone down early. And I just wonder, with everything that Davy Russell has been through, it would just be extraordinary after he was out for 11 months with his rehabilitation. Is there a chance he might win this and say, that's it?
I wouldn't like to be inside the mind of a man who has a brilliant temperament for this job. If somebody's got the right stuff in their veins to ride the kind of race that needs to win a Gold Cup, it's Davy Russell. He's got such a great record round here.
So Galvin down at the start, here's the parade.
Right, let's start with the one right at the bottom. That's number 11, Tornado Flyer, who won the King George on Boxing Day at 28-1, a 9-1 chance here. And don't forget, he was third in the Ryanair last year.
The Skelton boys have got Protectorat in the yellow colours of John Hales, also owned by Jed Mason, Lisa Hales and Sir Alex Ferguson. Good luck to them, and led up today by Hannah Hayward.
Royal Pagai comes next for the Venetia Williams stable. Any rain that fell was a bonus for him. He was 22 lengths second to Aputar at Haydock.
John Ferguson in the hat there rides Aputar every day. Good luck to him. Rachel Blackmore riding for Henry de Bromhead. Aputar.
Asterion Folange comes next, another one for Willie Mullins. He has a bad habit of tipping up in races, but he's clearly talented. The trip could be a question mark.
The first cap for the Donnellys, carried by Album Photo. He won in 2019 and 2020.
And wouldn't this be a fairy tale for Harriet Graham and Gary Rutherford from the Scottish Borders? I write an 80-1 shot here.
JP McManus on Chantry House, the Marsh winner. Nico de Boinville for Nicky Henderson.
Manila Indo comes next, last year's winner. Been beaten three times since, but better last time out.
And the last one down was Santini, who was second in 2020 for the Kelvin Hughes family. Nick Schofield riding for Polly Gundry, a 50-1 chance. Mick, that would be some story if Polly Gundry could win a Gold Cup.
Unbelievable. I think, you know, it would be a fairy tale. He needs to find his mojo, the mojo that's on finishing a close second to Albion Fortune.
AP, you like this horse, Galvin, in Ronnie Bartlett's colours for Gordon Elliott. And when that rain came on Wednesday, it was torrential. You thought, we've got a soft ground Gold Cup. We've got anything but that, haven't we?
Yeah, we have anything but that. But I think this horse is pretty adaptable in terms of ground. I found it interesting that Gordon Elliott said he was working like he had more speed recently. He won the National Hunt Chase here last year. I think he's been brilliantly trained. And I just think he's the horse that has the most solid form. But tactically, it's going to be a very interesting Gold Cup.
I just think of AP. Galvin went to the start with a red hood and didn't parade. There's no way I would have paraded if Galvin didn't have to parade. What about you?
No, I probably wouldn't have bothered either. I just went down to the start. You know, it's the Gold Cup, take him whatever fine or whatever you may get. But he has been pretty good in his races. That's the one thing I would say. But, you know, I just love how it's going to play out this race. You know, it's tactically, it's going to be fascinating.
Quickly to Brian.
A Blue Tar 11-4 for the Gold Cup. Galvin 130. Album Photo very, very strong each way. 12-1 this morning. A solid each way shot of 13-2. Manila Indo 13-2. There has been one bet, Protectorate, 12,500 each way at 11-1. And Office Money for Tornado Flyer, 30 grand each way at 10-1 to win 300 grand. The King George winner, Tornado Flyer, who's also trained by, yes, you've guessed it, Willie Mullins.
And Ruby, Manila Indo, no one seems to be talking about the defending champion whose form at Cheltenham is first, second, first. This place lights him up.
It does light him up, Ed, but I suppose conflated isn't exactly Frankie's form yesterday when he was well beaten when he fell in the Ryanair. So that's probably why they're overlooking him. I know Henry de Bromhead does fancy him, but look, form is form. And it'll be interesting, as AP says, to see how Robbie Power rides him. He's gone inside Santini, who's going to go forward. Album Photo's outside him. So, look, pace is going to be crucial to Manila Indo, Galvin and Album Photo. They don't possess the turn of foot that at Blue Tar or Protectorate do.
Oh, look, this is, look at how they're lining up here. They're going to bounce and go here. Position at the start could be crucial.
Stand by for Robbie Supple to raise that flag ahead of the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup, and your big race caller is Richard Hoyles.
And first timer for the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup, jumping exactly to time. And early on, Tornado Flyer, the horse that came from the back to win the King George and the Green and White Diamonds, is one of the first to show in the Boodles Gold Cup. Asterion for Lange, the grey towards the outside. Dual winner Album Photo and Santini with Manila Indo as we arrive at the first. Tornado Flyer wasn't great there. Royal Pagai is the early back marker. So the grey Asterion for Lange, the rider in grey, Santini, are the first two to show at fence number two. Manila Indo is towards the inside. Then Album Photo and I Right just caught a little wide as they make the turn. So out in the lead by two lengths, Asterion for Lange with a long way to go. Santini is in second, I Right races in third on the outside of Album Photo and Manila Indo. Galvin settles in midfield with Aplu Tar in the red, white and blue, Protectorate in the yellow. Tornado Flyer, having jumped off prominently, is now back in the customary position towards the rear, with Chantry House and Royal Pagai is the back marker of a pretty well-bunched field as they head on towards a plain fence. Grey Asterion for Lange lunges out to the right. Caused a bit of inconvenience to Santini, and I Right on the extreme outside moves forward now to share the lead as well. That trio are two lengths clear from Manila Indo and Album Photo, the previous winners, as they reach the water jump for the first time. Santini a bit slow, Protectorate a slightly scruffy jump, and his rider Harry Skelton briefly was pitched forward in the saddle, heading towards the first of the ditches. Asterion for Lange continuing to jump to the right. They are all over. Not the best leap by Aplu Tar, and Chantry House being rustled along at the back by Nico de Boinville, taking a while to warm up as we head towards another plain one. Asterion for Lange, I Right and Santini are the first three. Two lengths back to Manila Indo, who races on the inside of Album Photo. All Town End of Willie Mullins confirmed as the leading jockey and trainer of the week. Royal Pagai moving forward on the outside of the pink jacket as they take another open ditch. Protectorat comes next. Again, Chantry House was slow. He hasn't got into any rhythm yet. Aplu Tar tracking Manila Indo, the first two from 12 months ago. Galvin just popping away on the inside in the red cap. Towards the next. High Right picked up in front. Asterion Falange was slow. Gives second place to Santini as they prepare to turn downhill for the first time. So the order, I write for Callum Beauty, leads the Gold Cup field. What a moment for him, with in second place Asterion Falange. Fence at the top of the hill looms next. Over in third, Album Photo from Santini. Nella Indo and Galvin are the next two, with Protectorat. Royal Pagai still well there on the outside, and making some ground, Royal Pagai. He's just taking a little bit of a keen hold as they run downhill. Pink Jacket on the outer as I write leads. Royal Pagai up on the outside, Asterion Falange back on the inner, and Santini. Manila Indo and Album Photo, they're all pretty tightly bunched. Chantry House still just being humoured along at times by Nico de Boinville, but just the back of the field in the green and gold hoops with the white cap. So they've completed a circuit in the Gold Cup. I Write has led for the last half mile or so. Royal Pagai and Asterion Falange dispute second place. Santini on the outside of Album Photo. Manila Indo towards the inside in the maroon and yellow. Galvin with Tornado Flyer, Protectorat, Aplu Tar, and Chantry House, and the leaders all just bunching up. Chantry House two lengths off the back end. His rider has been the busiest. Once again, Asterion Falange moves forward with I Write and Royal Pagai as they reach the next. They're over in the lead, Santini in fourth place. So well bunched with everything still standing here as they make their way out into the country for the final time. Boodles, Cheltenham Gold Cup, and the crowd this time can roar them out on that final circuit with 10 fences to take. Out in the lead, I Write, Asterion Falange on the inside, Royal Pagai on the outer. Manila Indo and Album Photo still side by side. Santini just drifted back slightly, but is still there on the outside in the grey colours with Galvin, Aplu Tar, Protectorat, Tornado Flyer and Chantry House. And with 10 fences to take, the Gold Cup field completely intact and covered by no more than 8 to 10 lengths at this stage, as 9 fences remain. I Write racing towards the water jump for the final time. White with the red stars, Asterion Falange. Again, cumbersome in second place. Royal Pagai right on the premises. Manila Indo, Robbie Power just moving forward, getting a sight of the next obstacle, which is an open ditch with Album Photo as they prepare to take the eighth last. Everyone just manoeuvring a little bit for position here. Aplu Tar, Rachel Blackmore just trying to work through the field, getting onto the back of Album Photo and Manila Indo as Asterion Falange leads them over the next. They are all still over with 6 fences to take. The whole field are still standing, and the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup very much in the melting pot as they race towards 6 from the finish. This is the final open ditch. Asterion Falange and Royal Pagai. I Write now back in third, Santini in fourth. Album Photo ridden for the first time as Aplu Tar moves alongside Manila Indo with Galvin right behind them. Then towards the outer is Protectorat. Chantry House is being pulled up. Never really travelled Chantry House, and calls it a day as the leaders now make their way down towards the top of the hill. And out in the lead, it's Asterion Falange with Royal Pagai. I Write's lost the position as Manila Indo begins to improve. Santini comes next. Aplu Tar just looking for a bit of daylight. Red, white and blue. 4 from the finish. Royal Pagai didn't get very high there. There's still plenty of horses here with a chance. Asterion Falange, Manila Indo, the first one to break cover of the big guns. Album Photo, Aplu Tar drops onto Manila Indo's back. Protectorat over on the far side. Galvin being nursed into it as well. As the tempo begins to lift, they've left Tornado Flyer behind. 3 out in the Gold Cup. Asterion Falange, Royal Pagai and the reigning champion. Manila Indo travelling up strongly. Album Photo looking for his third Gold Cup is on the premises. Protectorat, Aplu Tar is being ridden, but off the final bend, Manila Indo at present in command by 2 lengths. Protectorat, Album Photo, Aplu Tar, Royal Pagai and Asterion Falange. Manila Indo has made his dash for glory, and he's 4 lengths clear of the second last in the Gold Cup from a wave of 5 horses. Manila Indo, Aplu Tar is now out after the leader in the red, white and blue. The first two from 12 months ago head down towards the last. Manila Indo, Aplu Tar for Rachel Blackmore, draws alongside of the last and jumps to the lead. Aplu Tar comes 2 lengths clear from Manila Indo, Royal Pagai, Galvin and Protectorat, and Aplu Tar, Rachel Blackmore, the heavy to Bromhead, second last year, is running right away with the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup. Another big race for Rachel Blackmore. Manila Indo in second ran gallantly.
the tight for third protectorate, Galvin, Raoul Pagai, Album Photo, Asterion Falange, Santini, Eyewright has got round. Tornado Flyer was pulled up. Aplutar took command and ran right away from them up the hill. Rachel Blackmore was forced to see Manila Indo, the horse she turned down 12 months ago, win the Gold Cup. This time, she left him in her wake as she streaked clear. On that, Protectorate may have got third ahead of Galvin, Raoul Pagai. Then behind those, Album Photo. A look to the heavens for Rachel Blackmore. What a 12 months it has been for her. This was the one that got away 12 months ago. This time, very much in safekeeping.
She made no secret of the fact she had unfinished business after last year. She said winning the Gold Cup is what dreams are made of. Henry de Bromhead's done it again. Rachel Blackmore has won the Gold Cup. She is the all-conquering queen of Cheltenham, Ruby.
Patience, Ed, patience. She went after Manila Indo last year and got to him too soon. She was stuck behind a wall of horses this year, but didn't panic, waited and used that turn of foot. Challenged Manila Indo going to the last. I know I have a 12-year-old at home who is probably gutted because she wanted to do something Rachel Blackmore this afternoon and be the first lady to win a Gold Cup. But here, she goes between Protectorate and Album Photo. Manila Indo jams on going to the second last and she lands behind him. But it was timing. She switches outside and produces this horse going to the last. She went too soon on him last year. She'd gone too soon on him at Leopardstown. But the big thing about making mistakes is learning from them. And she learned from them on this horse. Flies the last and away he goes to the line. He's a very good horse and given a very good ride on the day. It was a stop-start race, but she always stayed in the pockets and she has rewritten the history book again, Ed.
Rachel, it was the one that got away last year. You're now a Gold Cup winning jockey. That looked quite a rough race.
Oh, I can't believe it. I don't know what kind of race it was. I don't know. I just can't believe. I'm so lucky to be getting to ride all these good horses. Like, you can't do this without the horses. And being attached to Henry's Yard is just absolutely phenomenal. Like, look what he's after giving me. This horse is just unbelievable, and I don't know what to say.
You won the Grand National. Where does this fit in alongside these great wins, the two champion hurdles, the Grand National, now a Gold Cup?
Oh, such special days. I wouldn't swap the Grand National for anything. But this is the Gold Cup, and I wish I had something better to say right now. I just can't. You know, you have all these plans about how things are going to work out, and you know, racing doesn't let that happen a lot of the time. And for some reason, it's happened for me today, and I just can't explain how freaking lucky I feel.
Can I have a quick word with you, John?
Yeah.
You've done an amazing job with this horse. How proud are you of it?
I absolutely can't believe it. Literally, everyone's so good, and I couldn't do it without Henry and Rachel and everyone back home. It's absolutely amazing.
Well done, guys. Enjoy.
Just fabulous, this, for the sport. The champion hurdle, Gold Cup double for Rachel Blackmore. And I want to mention him now because he'll get lost in this. Henry de Bromhead won the champion hurdle on Tuesday. He did the Holy Trinity last year, and now he's had a 1-2 in the Gold Cup back-to-back years. Sum that up, AP.
It's an amazing training performance there. To get horses to come back to the top level 2 years in a row, to the championship races, the very best. I think what Ruby said, the stop-start pace, I think, is what really helped this horse. He was the fastest horse in the race, and he won a grade one over 2 miles, but he was given a brilliantly cool ride. And this is what dreams are made of. And walking down the chute, front of everyone in the stands at the Cheltenham Festival, there is nothing like it. There, you could have all the success in anything else in the world, there is nothing like riding a Gold Cup winner and walking down past everyone.
And I feel like it wouldn't be that long ago that we would have made quite a big deal of the fact that a female jockey was just riding in the Gold Cup, but now it's commonplace, and to see Rachel winning it, we're not really that surprised because of her talent, but it must be so
satisfying for her after being beaten a bit last year to turn the tables this year?
Well, if you ask her, you know, she doesn't ever want to take away from what she did last year. Winning six races at the Cheltenham Festival takes some doing, leading rider. But she still felt there was something missing. The Gold Cup, the one that she picked wrong. She wanted to right the wrong of last year. I think it's fairly safe to say she's done that. And the emotion in her voice when she was talking, I don't think I've ever heard that from Rachel Blackmore. This means an awful lot to her.
She is a global sporting star. Aplutar has won the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup, the 3-1 favourite in the end. Last year's champion Manella Rindo second at 7-1. Protectorat for the Skelton's third at 10-1. And just look at these seas. Drink in these pictures and this noise. One, her popularity. And two, as you said yesterday, great sports people put something behind them and get it right the next time. That must have hurt for 12 months, and she's come and put it right.
Yeah, we've definitely hurt for 12 months. I know Francesca said, whoever would have thought a female jockey would win a Cheltenham Gold Cup? I suppose not many people until Rachel Blackmore came along. Now you think she's just going to win everything, don't you?
And what about Cheveley Park, Francesca? David Thompson will be looking down, how he'd have loved this. Richard is here. And they've just had this golden spell, haven't they?
Oh, a phenomenal success rate with the National Hunt horses. Of course, the colours, for a long time, probably better known for their exploits on the flat, the likes of Pivotal and Russian Rhythm, etc. Many, many countless stars, but over the National Hunt as well. This is a crowning moment with the Gold Cup.
And I've just seen Patricia Thompson is here, awaiting Aplutar in the winner's enclosure, which is moments away, scenes that will reverberate. I said they're watching in America, they'll be watching this all around the world. And you'd hope she might be on the front pages tomorrow too. As we watch it again, AP, Manella Rindo, you thought at this point had gone for home and might not be seen.
Yeah, I thought off the bend he might get there, but as I said, the fact that there were so many of them closely bunched coming down the hill around the bend of the second last would tell you in a Gold Cup that they obviously haven't gone, you know, as we said, a stop-start gallop obviously wasn't, you know, end-to-end, if you like, and that, I presume, played into this horse's, you know, played into his hands, played to his strengths. He's a fast horse. He won a 2-mile grade one, as I said. But it was a very impressive performance. And as I say, for Rachel Blackmore, she has been some saviour for race. Not that it needs a saviour, but she, you know, we're so lucky to have her.
There's Henry. His reaction, delighted. He's done it again. What a trainer he is. And I'm sure people would have been cheering Rachel up and down the land.
Go on,
and
Blackie. Go
in
on,
our
Blackie.
Analysis hub.
Go on, Rach! Get in there!
Great selection that, Ruby, too.
Well, I'm not sure about the choice of words, Ed, but anyway, I do apologise if I offend anybody. But look, a wonderful performance from her. Look, I think, Ed, it was the coolness to hang on to the horse down the hill, to let the wall of horses in front of you, to have the confidence to allow the Gold Cup winner go in front of you, knowing that's the only way you could beat him, and then to find the way through. Magic, absolute magic.
Led in on the right there by John Ferguson, who rides Aplutar every day. About to be met by the Thompsons, who've won a Gold Cup for Cheveley Park. Henry de Bromhead wins it for back-to-back years. But listen to this. Rachel Blackmore has won the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup. Some lovely moments there, what the sport is all about. Ronnie Bartley, you saw coming over to offer congratulations. There's Maureen Mullins as well, having a... Oh, that's lovely, saying well done to Rachel. That's Richard Thompson. And his mum, Patricia, is there as well, in those famous Cheveley Park colours. And there she is. She's done it. beautiful moments, Mick.
Yeah, look, for Rachel Blackmore, she'll enjoy this because this is the one that got away. Ruby knows what this feels like. You know, when you ride, you pick have a choice to make of two horses in a race and you pick the wrong one. It's a horrible feeling. But it almost makes this victory even sweeter. And that's, you know, I hope that's a memory that's etched in her mind forever, because, you know, AP will tell you, when you walk into this hallowed winner's enclosure, winning a Gold Cup, there is no greater feeling. The Gold Cup is the race every jockey wants to win.
And dreams, it's all about dreams. And she was here last year. Yeah, she beat everyone. She won six races and all that, but she didn't have the crowd. She didn't have the people to appreciate how brilliant she is, and today she's getting it, and it's great for her that she's going to get all that adulation.
And likewise, kids. I know we often talk about Rachel's inspiring young girls. She's inspiring youngsters all over the place, boys and girls, seeing what she's doing.
Well, everybody here today wants a picture with Rachel Blackmore because they, you know, she is somebody who can make, you know, look, I've got a little girl, and like if she wants to be a rider, she'll look up to somebody like Rachel Blackmore and say, if Rachel Blackmore can do it, so can I.
I think it'll take her a very long time to get anywhere for the rest of today. Everyone wanted to congratulate her and take a photo and say a big well done. And it is remarkable when you reflect on her career, because she is 32 years of age, and it did take her a long time to get going. For a while, she only rode 7 winners in 5 years. She only turned professional in 2015, first Cheltenham winner 2019, and now look at her.
Yeah, well, when she came to here, of course, she couldn't even ride in the conditional jockey's race. She was too old.
You must be enjoying this, Ruby.
Yeah, I am. I was just listening to Mick talk about his daughter looking at Rachel Blackmore. Mine are the very same. Like, my eldest, all she wanted to do was win a Gold Cup, because it was something Rachel Blackmore hadn't done. So now she can't even do that. But she is inspiring kids everywhere. To watch her go to pony clubs during the summer, she came to our one in Kildare, to the Tipperary's. She's incredible, the interest she's driving in the sport. And you need role models like that for people, for the sport and for the industry. And she is box office.
I'm not sure what else she can win. Let's remember, last year she was the RTE, she was the Irish Times Sportswoman of the Year, she was the BBC World Sports Star of the Year. And what I love about her, Ruby, and we saw her earlier today, she was so calm, she was chatting to everyone, she was relaxed, she's polite to everybody, and yet we saw it riding in that race, how ruthless and cold she can be come race time.
Oh, she is, and, you know, that's a persona she puts on, but look, I've watched her coming in and out of William Mullins's for the last month, and she'd obviously be in Henry's as well, and you could see the pressure in her. It's a huge week, so she has a ruthless streak, but I'm not sure she's always as polite as she lets on, Ed.
She is a superstar. And that was an A-plus display in the Boodles Cheltenham Gold Cup. For Cheveley Park, Henry de Bromhead, à plus tard for the sensational Rachel Blackmore. What a buzz around Cheltenham. We've all just witnessed history with Rachel Blackmore winning the Gold Cup on the brilliant à plus tard. Second last year, first this. And the presentation's about to get underway with the Princess Royal here and how she will enjoy presenting that prize. As we go to Rishi first.
Well, Henry's in the winner's enclosure after the Gold Cup, as he was last year. But now he's got Richard Thompson alongside him from Cheveley Park. Henry, first of all, a 1-2 in the Gold Cup for the second successive year. Can you believe it?
No, definitely not. Just incredible. Amazing. And, yeah, fair play to everyone involved. Unbelievable. And just delighted for these guys. It's brilliant.
Well, it's been some week for Cheveley Park, Richard, but this is something else.
Oh, this just tastes the biscuit. I mean, to win the Gold Cup is a dream, you know. It's a dream for many years. My dad is obviously not here anymore, but it was his idea. Let's try and buy a Gold Cup horse. We won the Gold Cup. My mum's here, obviously. It's fantastic. Henry, Rachel, everybody who's here. It was absolutely an amazing moment. I just can't believe it.
Henry, can I just ask what it was like watching the race as Manello Endo picked it up? Rachel set off in pursuit.
Yeah, well, she didn't really. I thought she was so brave. She kept sitting and sitting. And, yeah, you know, Robbie gave Endo a brilliant ride, kicked on. And like, just, I don't know, the pace Aplutard showed was just incredible, to have that pace at the end of 3 miles.
I was just about to say, yeah, for a horse to do what he did at the end of 3.25 miles, yeah, here at Cheltenham, of all places.
Well, we saw him at the Betfair Chase, obviously, in November, and that was absolutely class. He's done the same again today. And, I mean, to do it at Cheltenham in the Cheltenham Gold Cup, I mean, it's fantastic for Henry, fantastic. I mean, Rachel, I mean, what? I mean, it's unbelievable. She's won the Gold Cup. We've won the Gold Cup. Henry's won the Gold Cup again. It's just fantastic.
This is the most extraordinary sport. Watching, you know, talking to you during the winter months where things weren't going well. Now you stand here, you've got Honeysuckle of one, now this horse, and a 1-2 again.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. You know, it's just, look, it's with the support of people like the Thompsons and the Maloneys and Kenny, everyone, all our owners. Like, they give us the opportunity to train these amazing horses, and yeah, we're extremely lucky.
And Richard Cheveley Park, yourself, your parents have enjoyed some wonderful, wonderful days in the world of flat racing and here in the world of jump racing. What does this one mean?
Oh, this is right up there, right up there. I mean, right now it's the number one moment because we're here, but this is just fantastic. We won the Grand National 30 years ago, but this is certainly right up there. Rachel riding, Henry training, what a fantastic combination. I mean, yeah, it's up. It'll never leave my memory, 100%. You know, always with me, definitely.
Well, many congratulations to Henry. Well
thanks,
done.
Thanks.
Isn't that wonderful? Patricia Thompson with that coveted trophy. But all eyes are on this lady. What a roar that was as she lifted her trophy. And I imagine Michael Wainwright, who's on the left there, and Boodles will be delighted on their first year of the sponsorship. There's Richard Thompson at the back there, Henry de Bromhead on the right, the chairman, Martin St. Quinton, far right, the victorious team. What a noise that was.
Yeah, an amazing atmosphere, and rightly so. She missed out on all that adulation from last year. Cheveley Park, an amazing operation. It had lots of Royal Ascot winners, lots of Guineas winners. I wonder would Mrs. Thompson think that winning a Cheltenham Gold Cup, I wonder if she ever really experienced an atmosphere like that before. I'm not sure.
Hopefully we'll be able to ask her in a second. We're going to try and get her over. You know, the initial reaction was so difficult with Alice. She might be more composed now, Mick.
It was, do you know what, it was lovely seeing those shots of Rachel. She was almost shaking her head in disbelief. I've finally won a Gold Cup. Like, this is a... Look, I don't care who you are, but you have to be moved by what you've seen today. She has done something very special, and you can tell it means an awful lot to her.
And still here in the winner's enclosure.
Yeah.
Standing room only, up on the balconies above, up on the balconies of the stands behind, everybody craning to get a view of Rachel there with the Gold Cup. It's an incredibly special moment.
While this is happening, we try and get Rachel. Other horses to run well. Manella Rindo, defending his crowns, run a big race. Protectorat in the end was third.
Yeah, and Galvin as well. He came back again. Looked like Davy Russell got chopped for room and had to switch outside. And in the end, he stayed on really well. But Rachel Blackmore, I think it's safe to say, is enjoying this.
So she should. Lapping this up. And look at the amount of people watching. I mean, literally, I'm looking behind him. The vantage point's being taken in this wonderful amphitheatre that I talked about earlier. The development of this place is just perfect. And there are the snappers, and I hope this is a photograph that will reverberate. Ruby, some race.
Yeah, it was a cracking race, Ed, but we were worried beforehand where the pace was going to come from. And when it turned down the hill, you had Asturian Falange, Royal Pagai, Manila Indo, Anna Plutarch spread across the track. Rachel Blackmore's in the pocket behind with Galvin, but she's not rushing. Robbie Power's going to commit when he lands over this. But Rachel, it was the patience. You heard Henry mentioning the bravery she had. But when Robbie goes forward, Paul Townend rows in. Now she's in a pocket, but she doesn't go outside Protectorat. She sits and waits. She's looking at the Gold Cup hero, quickening off the bend in front of her, but she's not panicking or not trying to get out. She's going to chase him this year rather than get beside him and help him. I mean, the split does come between Protectorat and Album Photo. She then goes after Manila Indo. Now, he gets a bit lonely in front and slows at the second last, which allows Rachel to close quicker. She gets onto his tail then, heading towards the last, but she's a bit left. She had that turn of foot that the slow pace was going to allow her have. Spots a stride at the last, not a long one, but kept tapping him on the shoulder all the way in. Jumps so well, lands running, and now it's just put your head down and go to the line. That is an incredible feeling. AP knows what it's like, so does Fitzy, so do I. I can't verbalise what that feeling is, but it's one I enjoyed and would love to experience again.
And what about the other runners in the race? Where did your money go? Let's hear from some of the other jockeys.
Danny Mullins rode Tornado Flyer.
I just didn't get into a rhythm jumping like Kempton and, yeah, just pulled up when we weren't going anywhere.
Brian Cooper rode Asterion for Lunch.
Yeah, best he's ever travelled and jumped. Just probably isn't the best there. Maybe go back and trip and he could be riding our horse next year.
Paul Townend rode Album Photo.
Jump better probably with the cheek pieces, and we had our chance and we weren't good enough this year either.
Callum Bewley rode I Write.
Yeah, no, he made a good account of himself. I thought, you know, just five out, four out, life gets hard, and you know what I mean, when he's a bit wrong at the weights with them other horses, it told, you know what I mean, but no, we're happy with him, you know.
Charlie Deutsch rode Royal Pagai.
Good run. He jumped well in most part, two big mistakes, but he kept on up the hill, and a bit softer ground there wouldn't mean a huge amount in it anyway, so no, really happy.
Robbie Power rode Manella Indo.
No excuses, he's run a cracker, jumped brilliantly the whole way, travelled beautifully. I thought off the bend down to the second last, he quickened down, but thought I'd go and win the race, and just beaten by better horse on the day, absolutely no excuses.
Harry Skelton rode Protector out.
Yeah, he ran really well, very proud of him. Thought three out, you know, we might have a real chance. I thought it might be, but look, couldn't have asked any more. The winner was very good.
Here she is, folks. Rachel Blackmore trying to have some water. I don't blame you. The first question, Rachel, after we spoke at Aintree, you've won the Gold Cup. Can you believe you're Rachel Blackmore?
I don't have a good answer for you this year, I'm sorry. I can't believe that's not even 12 months ago. Like, I don't know how I am this lucky. Like, phenomenal.
Talk us through the race, Rachel. How did it all unfold for you?
Yeah, I was happy. I was kind of where I wanted to be. It's probably more horses in front of me throughout the race than I wanted, but I had the four horses, three horses around me that I wanted to be around me. I had a wall of horses in front of me turning in, but they made sure I didn't go too soon like I did last year. It's just incredible. Like, he, tried to hold on to him a bit more this year, and look, it worked.
Did you think when Manila Endo went off the bend, do you think he was gone, or were you okay?
Do you know what? I was happy if he did go and I didn't get him. I was just happy I wasn't upsides him this year, and I was trying to do something different. And I kind of knew after the second last that I'd more horse under me than I did last year. And
that helps.
Yeah, I didn't think I'd be 15 lengths clear, though. Someone just said I was. Like, incredible.
Rachel, is this, you can tell, is this the one, this is the race that you've always wanted?
Oh, look, I didn't even, you know, when I took out my licence, I didn't think I'd be riding in Cheltenham, let alone a favourite in the Grand there in the Gold Cup. But, like, you know, I'm so lucky to be getting the chance to ride horses in these kind of races. And, this is the Gold Cup, you know what I mean?
And Ruby is down that lens, Rachel. He's offering the biggest congratulations. He's roared you home. He's absolutely thrilled for you. And he's just asking the question, were you surprised and how pleased were you they went so steady early?
Oh, look, it was ideal for me. It was. He jumped really well this year. I was in my comfort zone everywhere, and I was just happy everywhere. You know, it's lovely when you're in a race like that and you're where you want to be, and yeah.
And Rachel, you probably don't really think of yourself there yet, but we will be discussing how you're such a role model for the younger generation. If you had a few words to say to kids who look up to you, what would you say?
Oh, look, I never even dreamt I could be doing this, and I am. So I suppose, you know, you can, what I'm doing now is a dream I could never allow myself to have, because it was not even in my reality, I suppose. So, I suppose you can never dream too big, because, you know, this is something I never thought would be possible.
Rachel, whatever you do, milk it.
All of it. I'll copy you.
So many congratulations from everyone, Rachel. Well done.
Yes,
thank you.
Well done.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, AP.
Lovely. There she is, racing's golden girl.
has won the Gold Cup. We just witnessed something very special indeed. We've got one more race to come. Ahead of that, 26 people are still going for our biggest ever ITV7 jackpot, £500,000. There'll be 26 very nervous people, Richard.
Yeah, they are indeed, Ed. I'll give you those when we run through the runners and riders. Sad news about Ginto. We thought at the time that injury looked catastrophic, and unfortunately Ginto did not survive it and was quickly put to sleep. So our thoughts are with Connections. One moment going as if you were going to win a race at the Cheltenham Festival, and real heartfelt commiserations to all of those close to Ginto. Georgie Robarts officiates on the scales for the last time here as well. She's been very much involved in the point-to-point scene, very helpful to commentators down the years, and we wish her a very happy retirement and delighted that she's officiating today on the race that means a lot to her. So St James's Place Festival Challenge Cup, headed by number one Back Bar for Izzy Marshall. Two Billaway carries 12 of those ITV7 tickets. Remember, there will be a tie break, Patrick Mullins and Willie Mullins. Three is Bob & Co, five tickets there for David Maxwell. Great if he could win. Four is Cousin Pascal, winner of the Fox Hunters at the Cheltenham, at the Aintree Festival. James King for Joe O'Shea over those big obstacles. Number five, Désir Dujoie for Archie Wright. And number six is Don Bursey, who sometimes doesn't start. You can see all those R's in his form. Tommy O'Brien for Ryan Potter. Seven Dubai Quest, one solitary hit on Dubai Quest. So if you're that holder, you'll scoop the lot. Gina Andrews and Tom Ellis. Number eight, Fume Duderi for Zach Baker and Tom Ellis as well. Nine, It Came to Pass for the O'Sullivans, Maxine and Eugene. And Alluri, and carries two tickets. Ten is Lord Schnitzel for Chris O'Donovan, Declan Queeley. 11, Mighty Stowaway for Jamie Codd. Jamie, one of the more experienced riders in this, of course, for Gordon Elliott. 12, one big chit-chat for Christopher Furness and Jill Wolford. 13, Overworked Underpaid, George Chatterton for Laura Morgan. 14, Point the Way for Joe Wright and Guy Brewer. 15, Pont Avon for Alex Chadwick, James Owen. 16, carries two tickets, Premier Magic, Bradley Gibbs. 17, this one for Rachel Blackmore, rewrite the rules. David O'Brien and riding and training. And only 18, Senior Lombardy for Lyle Hodgkins. And 19, Wing Leader carries four tickets. This is the last one, as 20 doesn't run, for Barry O'Neill and David Christie. So 19 runners in this year's St James's Place Festival Challenge Cup.
I can't tell you enough how terrible this will be for the bookies if Billaway goes in. We started the show emphasising this will be the punter's day. The bookies are absolutely finished after a Plutard, State Man, all the good things have gone in, Vauban, and now Billaway is smashed up. 9-4, 2, 7-4, 13-8. This isn't quite Frankie Dettori's Magnificent Seven, but it's absolutely desperate for the bookies. Wing Leader at 9-2, Bob & Co Popular at 5.5, Dubai Quest at 6.5. Cousin Pascal at 12 and 14 bar, but if Billaway goes in, it'll be the end for some of the bookies.
And Mick, there's every chance that's going to happen. The bookmakers will be quaking. I always love to see the small, the people who've turned up for the Fox Hunters, yeah, or the Festival Challenges, it's now called now, in their one horse box with their family, and yet they're taking on the might of Willie Mullins.
Yeah, absolutely, and have a very good chance of toppling the might of Willie Mullins as well. This Billaway has been beaten a couple of times here, been a very sharp price favourite, beaten a short head last year when Patrick Mullins wasn't able to ride. He'll be hoping that this is the one, and I just feel that, you know, when you look, Dubai Quest is another one who's of interest in here, but I just feel that,
Don Bursey's going to hold things up again here.
Yeah, he's a bit alphabetical. He's got a few R's, refused to race a couple of times.
I think Bob and Co would be the best story of all, though, wouldn't it?
David Maxwell
to win a race at Cheltenham Festival.
To a big audience, why David Maxwell would be such a good story?
Well, he's the out-and-out amateur, isn't he? He works every day and he rides for fun. And, you know, he said after he rode a winner one day, it was the most fun he'd ever had with clothes on, you know what I mean? It was like, you know, it was just it'd be an amazing story. Proper amateur and loves
Corinthian, I think is what you call that.
Yeah. Okay, well done, Ruby. That's it.
But Ruby, do you think Billaway is going to be very
great chance? Him? Headgear will be a big help to him. I think he's looked around in the last couple of years, Francesco, so the headgear will be a big help to him. But a shrewd judge even put Premier Magic up to me last night. I don't know much about Hunter Chase form, and I know nothing about English point-to-point form, but a guy I would listen to did mention Premier Magic last night. No, I said a guy I would listen to.
And we were watching Rachel there. I mean, she was visibly shaking, and AP made the point of saying to her, milk it, enjoy it. I imagine you'd say similar.
Oh, of course you would, but that's us looking back in hindsight thinking we didn't milk it enough, but it's probably not that easy to milk it.
Let's hope David Maxwell might be milking it after this. Richard.
So Don Bursey, they've deliberately kept him on the move, down late. He's joined in with the others. Will he jump away? He will. Just about. Don Bursey is with them. A reminder to get him going. It's away we head then. The Fox Hunter's cousin Pascal is one of the first with Dubai Quest as they head towards the first of the 22. Mighty stowaway towards the inside. Race is in a handy position as well as they approach the first. Lord Schnitzel not too far away. Overworked and underpaid, nearly came down. It's rider won't get a fee, of course, being an amateur, but he earned it there. It's out on the outside. Don Bursey is moving through to dispute the lead early on. So they're all safely over the second, although Fume Duderi and Overworked and Underpaid are out the back. So Don Bursey didn't want to start originally, or hasn't done on plenty of occasions, but he's four or five lengths clear here from racing in second place. Cousin Pascal on the inside of Dubai Quest. Winged Leader races in fourth place on the outside in the noseband. Billaway's in the yellow jacket, just tracking the leaders in the early stages. Mighty Stowaway's white face is also pretty handy. And towards the outside, Senor Lombardy as they race towards the third fence. Don Bursey leads them over it. Bob & Co at this stage is towards the back. Overworked and Underpaid, It Came to Pass is towards the rear as well, in company with Rewrite the Rules as they head towards the water jump for the first time. Out in the lead, Don Bursey over. Well, Mighty Stowaway continues to dispute second place, in company with Cousin Pascal. Cousin Pascal in the noseband. Out a little wider is Dubai Quest, and widest of all is Winged Leader as they approach an open ditch. Billaway takes it in sixth or seventh place, just behind at this stage Lord Schnitzel, with racing towards the inside. For Premier Magic just behind them as they take the next fence. They're all over that. So out in the lead, Don Bursey makes the turn first. Winged Leader races in second. In third place, that's disputed by Dubai Crest, who races on the outside of the orange and purple of Lord Schnitzel and the noseband of Cousin Pascal as they reach the next fence. And once again, they are all over. It Came to Pass has dropped right to the back of the field at this stage. So out in the lead, Don Bursey from in second, Winged Leader. In third, towards the inside, Mighty Stowaway. As they head on towards the next fence, Desire de Joie on the inside got a little bit tight there, right on the inner. So there's not much space there. Cousin Pascal, Billaway just behind them as they make the turn downhill. Bob & Co has grabbed hold of the bit and has moved closer. Back Bar races in midfield, just ahead of the maroon and green colours of Monbeg Chit Chat as they take the next out, which again, Desire de Joie made a mistake. And we lost to Bob & Co. Bob & Co has gone at that fence. Momentarily obscured. Hopefully the horse, I think, is galloping away behind the field. Hopefully he is okay. Hopefully the same for David Maxwell. But Bob & Co is the one that came down there. So Don Bursey it is who leads them over that next fence. A few just beginning to struggle. Premier Magic is one of them, who's quite well behind. As out in the lead, Don Bursey leads Winged Leader in third place on the inner. Continues to race Mighty Stowaway. Dubai Quest is out wide, and between that pair is Lord Schnitzel. Sixth place for Cousin Pascal, who's on the inside of Billaway. David Maxwell's up on his feet okay, which is great to hear. Pont Aven comes next, Senor Lombardy towards the outside. Then Desire de Joie, whose rider's done well after a couple of errors to maintain the partnership. Bombay Chit Chat comes next from Rewrite the Rules, as they all step over that. Underworked and Underpaid is also towards the back of the field. Behind Overworked and Underpaid, we have Point of the Way. Still towards the rear is It Came to Pass. So Don Bursey it is who's still out in the lead. And they've all negotiated that safely. At the back of the field, Premier Magic is being pulled up. So Premier Magic is pulled up in front of the stands. Those that remain, still headed by Don Bursey, set out on their final circuit. Don Bursey out in the lead from in second place, Mighty Stowaway's White Face. Winged leader in the noseband races in third. In fourth place, being tracked by Lord Schnitzel, who travels okay with Dubai Quest. Billaway has always been in about sixth or seventh place, the yellow colours, with the horse on the body. And he's on the outside of Cousin Pascal, as Don Bursey got in a little bit close to that. Azir de Joie next. Fumé Doudary made a mistake. It came to pass. He's under strong pressure. Also overworked and underpaid is getting the hurry up. So Don Bursey still leading. Winged leader in second place as they race over the water jump for the final time with nine to take. In third place, up on the outside, Dubai Quest. A Mighty Stowaway still there in company with Lord Schnitzel, who's travelled comfortably throughout. Billaway, Cousin Pascal, Point Avon are the next group, with Senor Lombardy racing next. Desir de Joie, Monbeg Chit Chat, and it rewrites the rules. Being pushed along now is Backbar, who's lost a lot of ground. Overworked and underpaid is about to be pulled up as Don Bursey takes that rather by the roots, and Winged Leader draws alongside. So confirm, overworked and underpaid, pulled up before that fence. They're getting very remote indeed, a few of these now, as out in the lead, Don Bursey continues to dispute it with Winged Leader. Then behind these, Mighty Stowaway rises in third with Dubai Quest, as Don Bursey made a mistake, a bad mistake by Cousin Pascal as well, and he stopped very quickly and may be calling it a day. So they're thinning out as Don Bursey is also pulled up, having raced prominently for a while. Cousin Pascal is also being pulled up. So out in the lead, it is Winged Leader for Barry O'Neill, who has the advantage from Dubai Quest and Gina Andrews. Racing in third place, the purple and orange, Chris O'Donovan on Lord Schnitzel, on the outside of Mighty Stowaway for Jamie Codd. The leading group completed by Point Avon for Alex Chadwick, and then in sixth place is Billaway under Patrick Mullins, and these six are clear of Senor Lombardy as they now run down then towards the third last. Winged Leader out in the lead from Mighty Stowaway in second place. Racing in third is Lord Schnitzel. Dubai Quest is now under pressure. Billaway working hard to try and get on terms, and came to pass, has been pulled up. A Fumé Doudary has been pulled up, but still Winged Leader has the advantage towards the second last, being pressed all the time by Mighty Stowaway for Jamie Codd, and the two of them have pulled on from Billaway, who is running on, but the gap between Billaway and the front two is a wide one. Winged Leader for Barry O'Neill and David Christie, trying to see off Mighty Stowaway for Jamie Codd. Billaway is closing in third place, about six lengths back, as they race towards the second last. Winged Leader is over the second last, clear from Mighty Stowaway. Billaway in third place is staying on, but has given them a long start. Winged Leader out in the lead. Billaway edging closer. Winged Leader needs to keep the momentum up at the last. Pops over it clear. Billaway is in second place, the place he has filled in the last 2 years, and looks like he may well fill it again, because Winged Leader out in front is just beginning to stop. Billaway is now beginning to surge. Billaway is coming at Winged Leader. Billaway closing Winged Leader down. Billaway coming at him, and on the line, will get there. Heartbreak, I think, for Winged Leader, as Billaway punch at the air from Patrick Mullins. I think he thinks he's done him in the final stride. From Mighty Stowaway, Dubai Quest in fourth place. My word, Billaway has got there in the final bound to win by a neck. 16 people in the ITV7, 12 on Billaway, 4 on Winged Leader, who got a break, but he was so tired. And Billaway for Patrick and Willie Mullins looked set to finish second for the third year in a row, but the petrol ran dry on Winged Leader. Don't think Patrick knows for sure, he does now. Billaway's been called the winner. Billaway it is, who wins this race, having finished second the year ago. That's been the phone of the day, hasn't it, with Aplutar as well. Billaway wins the Hunter's Chase.
Patrick, how on earth did you bag that? You were never happy from about five out. Good lad.
No, look, he gets behind the bridle, and that's why I put the cheap pieces on, and he wasn't jumping fantastic. It was an effort for him. But in fairness, every time I asked him, he came, but he was very brave at his jumps. And I just thought when I landed back in second last, I said, I have a squeak here. And he stays so well. He's very brave. He deserves this. And Dave Porter looks after him. Magic man.
What a word for Dad for this extraordinary week.
Yeah, sure. He's all right what he does, isn't he? He's very good. He's an incredible amount of pressure. And look, to be the boss's son and get to ride his horses makes me a very lucky person.
Well then, enjoy the crowd.
Oh, what a result for punters. John Hughes, how bad a result is that for bookmakers?
We're gone. That's it. That's the last. I'll never be back at Cheltenham again. The white flag's gone.
Gone! What a festival!
Brilliant day for the punters. A day to remember for Willie Mullins, who has a new record. 9 winners is staggering, but every bookmaker up and down the land would have been cheering Winged Leader. That would have been agony for them. Brilliant for punters and the Mullins team. And Mr. Turner, who owns this horse. 16-10 on the Prestbury Cup, someday for Ireland.
The Turners who own this as well own Heaven Help Us as well. They have those very strange colours. They're significant. You'll see them orange and black, yellow and black.
They're yellow and Willie's, orange and Jesse's, yeah. Green and Jesse's, orange with Paul Hennessy. They had blue yesterday with somebody here in the UK.
With Donald McCain.
Donald McCain, yeah. And they have a red set as well. I don't know
That's
who has
confusing.
Them.
Bookmakers look away now. What a finish. Billaway wins at 13-8. Wing Leader, you have to feel for their team. Second at 9-2. That hill went on forever. The ITV7 has been won. We'll confirm how many and who as soon as we can. 100 grand on competition is open for tomorrow. Another note to tell you about on the Hub, if you want some more Rachel Blackmore, a grand year is well worth a watch. That's on the ITV Hub right now if you want more Rachel Blackmore, which people will, as Patrick punches the air. If you can, put into words what Willie Mullins is achieving here, Ruby. Because he's had 9, it could have been more.
Yeah, it could have been more. Obviously, Gallop and Champ tipped up, that would have been 10, but he still has chances. Ellie May and Carl Reavy and the Mrs. Paddy Power, and then adamantly chosen at 5 o'clock in the Martin Pipe. So, look, it is incredible. A big team, great investors, huge amount of owners, and they back him, let him do what he wants to do. He runs the horses where he wants to run them, and look, he aims them at here. His owners want to have runners here. This is what counts. As many people in the world can tell you, it's not about Cheltenham. You're buying horses, it's about here.
And let's talk about here this week, Francesca. How would you sum up the 4 days, do you think?
Well, I mean, before the festival, we were all looking forward to the crowds being back, weren't we? And that has just been the biggest factor, the biggest difference from last year, because the Cheltenham Festival is so defined by that. The winner's enclosure here, there's just nothing like it in the world. When you come back, the jockeys stand up in their arms and the cheer goes up. It is just a sensational feeling, and I'm so glad we're back.
Highlights, Mick?
Look, it started with Rachel on Tuesday and it ended with Rachel on Friday. I think it's fairly safe to say, you know, look, every race is a big race here, but the Gold Cup is the one that Rachel Blackmore wanted more than any after last year, and she has managed to bag it this year.
And who was the last jockey to complete the Champion Hurdle Gold Cup double, which she's done this year?
Someone a lot more miserable and ugly than Rachel Blackmore, I reckon.
It was you, wasn't it?
Yeah.
97?
97, 25 years ago. What was the documentary called last year?
A Grand Year, it's called.
Another Grand Year. Part two.
That's going to have to be a part two, isn't there? What an achievement. Ruby, your highlight of the week?
I don't know, it was the one highlight, Ed. It was just magic to be here. Like, from the novices in the first day, Constitution Hill, thought there was some brilliant riding, thought Danny Mullins, I thought Derek Fox and Corey Grambler was an exceptional ride as well. I mean, everyone goes on about him riding Richard the Lineman. That was the same thing, and the poor man's not getting the look in. You know, it was incredible stuff. It was great, start to finish.
And I hope people have enjoyed it here and at home as well. Camera guys have played a blinder this week, particularly on Wednesday and all that rain. And Richard Hoyles, take a bow, commentary absolutely faultless all week, even when the mud was flying. And I hope you've enjoyed it at home. The show rolls on. I'm looking forward to tomorrow, the big one, the Midlands Grand National. You can join Rishi in the morning from 9:30 with the opening show, and then we've got the live action from Uttoxeter and Kempton from 1:10 on the main channel again. More racing. And we'll look back on everything that's happened this week. And it's a week when we started, we said the racing needed to put a smile on people's faces. I think it's done that this week. And we have a lady who's won a Grand National and now a Gold Cup. How lucky are we all to have Rachel Blackmore? Bye-bye.
Jump Racing's cathedral has its Cotswold congregation back.
Constitution Hill roars up the Cheltenham Hill.
We're back, everyone! Yeah.
Edward Stone wins the Arkle! Stretch my hands up to the sky, we dance with monsters through the night! Cora Grambler for Scotland! I'm never gonna look back, whoa! I'm never gonna give it up, no!
champion hurdle for Honeysuckle remains unbeaten. This is going to be the best
day of my life. Today it's all about speed.
Sir Gerhard wins the Ballymore. Look at the money. Long Presley, a festival winner for Charlie Deutsch. In Nurgamy, he's bounding clear for Paul Townend. Willie Mullins in the lead by the champion. Delta Word is a real threat. Tiger puts his head down, but Delta Word is too strong on the day.
Tiger, from all of us, thank you.
Are we ready? Gallop and the shot. Up down. Bob Olinger ridden out. Remains unbeaten. Truth of now struggle on the run up towards the finish. Third win.
Here we go again.
Alaho, a truly class act. His back-to-back victories in the run.
It's Cheltenham Gold Cup Day. Not just a big day in racing, a big day in sport.
Steve Owen powers away to win the JCB Triad. And his state man another for Paul Townend and Willie Mullins. The nice guy is going to make it 4 out of 4. This nice guy doesn't finish second.
We're set for Jump Racing's most coveted trophy.